Am I audible? Okay. Good morning to all the dignitaries present over here. Myself, Heta Chabaya, on behalf of Dr. L. H. Hiranandani College of Pharmacy and Konkan Gyanpith Rahul Dharkar College of Pharmacy, welcomes you all to the fourth day of EED-FDP in collaboration with APTI and IPA. Today, our first speaker for the today's session is Dr. Harshal Pawar. Sir is currently working as an assistant professor with Dr. L. H. Hiranandani College of Pharmacy, Ulhasnagar. Sir has 15 years of teaching and industry research experience. He has also worked as a head of Department of Quality Assurance for 6 years. Sir worked with various pharmaceutical industries like Medley, Charak and Alkem Research Center, Mumbai. He has published more than 60 research and review articles in various national and international journals of repute. Sir has also presented various research papers in national and international conference, seminars, symposia and workshops. Sir has 2 Indian and 1 US and 1 international PCT patent to his credit. He has received research grants from University of Mumbai. Sir is on the editorial board and reviewer of the national and international journals. He has guided over 25 M-Pharmacy research scholars in the subject of quality assurance. Sir is also recognized PhD guide of University of Mumbai as well as Pacific University. He has authorized 8 books in the field of pharmaceutical sciences. Also, sir is a lifetime member of Association of Pharmaceutical Teachers of India, which is APTI, and American Society of Pharmacognosy. Sir, we welcome you all to the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Hita Madam, for such a wonderful introduction. So, first I'll share my PPT. Are you able to see my PowerPoint?
Yes, sir. Challenges in
the So, very good morning to all of you. At the outset, I would like to say thanks to our principal, Dr. Parag Gide, and principal of Rahul Dharkar College of Pharmacy, Dr. Mohan Kale, as well as the organizing committee member of this FDP program. Special thanks to Dr. Sanket Dharashukar sir and Mr. Pritam Zwadkar sir for giving me this opportunity to interact with all of you on the topic challenges in development of a discriminatory resolution method for a pharmaceutical product. The purpose behind selecting this particular topic was that when I went through several research publications, research articles published by different academic researchers, including MPharm and PhD students, especially from India, I have seen that most of the resolution methodology, what they have adopted, they were not up to the mark. Or I'll say those publications, especially which are done in predatory journals, they were of very poor quality, and even the procedures, the methodology, what they followed, those were not meeting the pharmacopoeia specifications or regulatory norms. And since I got this very good platform of FDP to interact with the faculty around the India, so I thought that why should not I use this platform to share my knowledge, whatever I have gained through my industry and academic research experience. So I'll start with my presentation. These are the contents of my today's presentation. I'll start with first the theoretical background or aspect of dissolution. I'll discuss about the challenges in especially selection of instrument, followed by prerequisites, especially for the development. Then I'll discuss the core challenges which are involved in the method development process for dissolution. Finally, I'll give my concluding remark, and then the session will be open for question answer. There is one common disclaimer that the content, whatever I'm going to present through this presentation, so that is solely my own opinion. And the figures and images, whatever I'm going to show you present here in this presentation, they are collected from open resources which are available, and they will only use for educational purpose, and it's not with any commercial intent. So before starting the theoretical aspect or background of the dissolution process, this dissolution, I just wanted to share with you two important slides. So just by going through these slides, you'll come to know the gravity of matter. So how serious this particular topic is, and how the formulator or the development scientist, he should be serious while developing pharmaceutical formulation, or can say any evaluation method for assessing the quality. You just look at the slide. So I have quoted some information which I Googled out yesterday. I just put dissolution failure US FDA letters in the Google, and I am very surprised to see that I got a list of various multinational pharmaceutical companies who have been failed in meeting the dissolution specification. So I have just picked out three major companies. One is Toron Pharmaceutical, second is Hitro Labs, and third one, it is also a very renowned pharmaceutical company, Mylan. This is one more slide. Here I have quoted the information pertaining to OCAD. So this was very serious, and you can say this particular recall of the pharmaceutical product, it was happened with OCAD. So almost three times the same product, that is metoprolol succinate extended release tablet, that is one of the very good anti-hypertensive product, it was withdrawn from the market, and around more than 1 lakh samples have been withdrawn, recalled from the market. Only the simple reason was there that these products, they failed to meet the dissolution specifications. And I think while going through all these contents, I came to know that to many pharma companies, FDA has issued recently 483, and even to some of the companies, FDA has issued a warning letter. So I think those who are sharing or who are investing the money in share market, they must be knowing, especially in pharma segment, that what is the impact of getting a warning letter or issuing a 483 by FDA to a pharmaceutical company. So obviously, it's not a joke to recall around more than 1 lakh bottles from the market. Obviously, the lot of finance is involved. So apart from the financial loss, this will have also a bad impact on the reputation of the pharmaceutical company. So therefore, this is very important and very crucial thing that formulator has to keep in mind. So now we'll start with the theoretical aspect of dissolution. So as you know that for any pharmaceutical product, there are three primary quality attributes which are generally used to assess the quality of the pharmaceutical product. So those includes assay, then next is dose uniformity, or if you see the pharmacopeia terminology, it is also known as uniformity of dosage unit. And third one is dissolution. So out of these three primary quality attributes, dissolution, it is very, very important since it is having direct relevance with the in vivo performance of the finished product. Now let us understand what is dissolution testing. Most of the times while interacting with students, I have seen that the students, they are generally mingling the two terms, one is solubility and second is dissolution. But keep in mind that both these terminologies, they are entirely different from each other. In dissolution, it is defined as the amount of solid substance that goes into the solution per unit time under the standard conditions. Whereas solubility, it means the maximum amount of solute or drug substance that enters into the solution or that get dissolved into the appropriate solvent under the standard condition. So dissolution, basically it is a dynamic process, whereas solubility is a static process. So this dissolution testing, it basically involves the study or monitoring of you can study the drug release rate from the formulation. So wherein you can quantify the amount of drug which is released from dosage form at the appropriate interval under the standard conditions. So obviously you're going to use the equipment or instrument, and that instrument is known as dissolution apparatus. And by using this dissolution apparatus, you're going to perform the dissolution testing. This is one general mechanism of dissolution, which is applicable for tablet formulation. There is initial mechanical lag, followed by wetting of the dosage form. So during wetting of the dosage form, the dissolution media that will penetrate into the dosage form, and it will bring about disintegration or deaggregation of the several components of the tablets. And during this period, that drug will come out from the complex matrix and it will enter into the solution form. That is nothing but dissolution. And once your drug is released into the solution form, it will get absorbed into the systemic circulation and you will get the therapeutic effect. Now let us see which are the products which can be tested by dissolution testing. So as per United States Pharmacopoeia, all those solid oral pharmacopoeial dosage forms which involves absorption of a drug, or wherein the absorption of drug is necessary to show the therapeutic activity or therapeutic efficacy. So this also includes some of the formulations like semi-solid formulations like suspension, even a chewable tablet, they are also subjected to this dissolution testing. There are certain exceptions to those tablets formulations or products which are meeting the requirements of completeness of solution and which undergo rapid disintegration. So such a products, they are excluded or they are getting exemption from this dissolution testing, wherein sometimes pharmacopoeia is recommending disintegration as a surrogate test for the dissolution testing. Now let us see what is the need of dissolution testing. So as you know that it is used as a routine quality control parameter to test or assess the quality of the pharmaceutical dosage form. So it is playing very key role in development and optimization of especially new drug formulations, wherein you can able to study the drug release pattern. Most of the times you are using different excipients, different grade of excipients and different compositions. So what is the exact impact of the different grades or a different quantity of excipients on the formulation, that on especially the release rate, that you can study by using dissolution testing. Apart from this, you can even study the batch to batch variation. Then you can study quality, safety, efficacy and stability of the product. The data which is obtained from dissolution testing, that is very much useful, especially for establishing in vitro in vivo correlation or further bioavailability study of the same product. Even this data, it is used to support waiver for bioequivalence requirement. I think this already discussed in the earlier topic, I think day before yesterday, Dr. Nagarjun has talked about generic formulations and their development. So in that case, this dissolution testing, it is very, very important and it is playing a crucial role because this data, it is the prime requirement of the regulatory agency. And of course, this dissolution data, it is useful in assessing pre and post approval changes in manufacturing process or formulations. So many a times, once the product is getting approval from the regulatory authorities, the manufacturer try to improve that formulation, bring about certain changes in the formulation. Either they are changing the quality of the excipients, or sometimes they are eliminating some excipients, or sometimes they are even adding some additional excipients, or may increase the concentration of excipients. So in that case, you need to support the appropriate data pertaining to the dissolution testing to the regulatory authorities for justification. So that becomes one of the regulatory requirement. This is a fishbone diagram. Basically, it is used in quality by design process, especially by the development scientist or what can say formulator who is designing the formulation. So just you look at this particular diagram, so you can get idea how to do the risk assessment by keeping this dissolution testing as one of the important or critical quality attribute. So through this fish bone diagram, I can able to explain to you the different factors which are affecting especially the release rate of drug from the dosage form. So the first factor is related to the manufacturing process. So as you know that the manufacturing, it involves different types of processes like compression, blending, coating. So all these factors, they are having impact on the rate of release of drug. In addition to this, the material and drug properties, especially their physical and chemical properties. Most importantly, the role of disintegrant in especially in tablet formulation, because this disintegrant, it is a part of it is a what you can say the part of the rate limiting step of dissolution process. And apart from this, of course, you need to take into consideration the experimental condition or what you can say dissolution conditions which are applicable. So that includes viscosity, then whether you will going to use sinkers or not, what kind of dissolution apparatus you're going to use, whether have you deaerated the dissolution media, what kind of composition of dissolution media you're going to use, how you're going to do the sampling. And at the end, apart from this, the role of some of the significant excipients which contributes especially or which helps especially in different steps or processes like disintegration. The role of these excipients also one need to take into consideration, and their concentration is playing vital role. So certain examples I have quoted here that the concentration of lubricant, even the quality of the lubricant, what you are adding, disintegrant and binder. These are some of the challenges what I have identified. So the first major challenge is selection of instrument or equipment. Second is the drug properties or API properties. So before going for formulation development, one has to understand first the various physicochemical properties of drug or active pharmaceutical ingredient. The third important challenge is the formulation properties. So one must know what is the dose, or what is the composition, and most of the times because of the content uniformity also, you may not be getting the appropriate dissolution results. So this is also facing challenges at several steps. And out of all these challenges, the biggest challenge which is there, that is in simulating especially the in vitro conditions which are having in fact direct relevance with the in vivo conditions. So that is, I think, biggest challenge. So one has to very careful while selecting the resolution conditions. And the last one is the analytical method development. So of course, sometimes one may have to go with the newer analytical method or sensitive analytical method. So again, to quantify the content released from the drug, one has to select the appropriate resolution method. So it also involves several challenges. Now let us understand the instrumental part, or the challenges which are involved in the instrumentation. So these are the different kind of instruments which are official in the different type of different pharmacopoeias. So in total, seven official resolution apparatus are there. So first two are very common and most commonly used for the dissolution testing of conventional formulation. One is basket apparatus, second is paddle apparatus. Third one is a reciprocating cylinder. Next is flow through cell, paddle over disc. This paddle over disc, this apparatus, it is very similar to the apparatus type 2, that is paddle apparatus. Only the thing is that in addition to paddle apparatus, it contains a small disc having a mesh at the bottom below the paddle, or below the paddle. And the type 6 apparatus of USP is a rotating cylinder, and last one is reciprocating disc. And apart from these official instruments or equipments, there are several non-official dissolution testing apparatus or modified apparatus are there, which also you can use, provided that you should have the justification that why you are not going with the official standard apparatus and why you are going for modified apparatus, especially to the regulatory agencies. If your justification is satisfactory, then only the regulatory agency will give you green signal. Now let us see how to select the apparatus. So certain guidelines have been provided in the United States Pharmacopoeia. So especially for solid oral dosage forms, you can use paddle and basket apparatus. The formulation where there is change in the pH required, so the formulations like modified release dosage form, so in that case you can go with apparatus 3 and apparatus 4. For transdermal products, you can use apparatus 5, 6 and 7. Even this apparatus 7, it is also used for non-disintegrating modified oral dosage forms. For semi-solid dosage forms, the flow-through cell is used. And one more apparatus I have mentioned here, that is diffusion cell, or it is also called as trans-diffusion cell. So this is falling under the category of non-official apparatus. And apart from this, you are free to use other non-official apparatus. These are the available variations for the dissolution apparatus. So you can change certain parts, or you can modify certain parts of the compendial apparatus, provided that you must have certain justification. Here I have quoted some of the changes what you can do, especially for basket type of apparatus. You can change the size of mesh size of the basket. Even you can change the vessel size. So typically it will go with the common methods or common methodology which are there in most of the pharmacopoeia. So majority of drug products, you'll see that the recommended dissolution volume is around 900 ml. For few products, you can get that this dissolution volume, it is around 500 ml. So the 1000 ml capacity vessel, that is enough to conduct this type of dissolution. But the cases where solubility of drug is very low, especially for poorly soluble drugs, it is very difficult to meet the sink conditions, especially with the volume around 900 or 1000 ml. So in that case, you'll have to go sometimes for larger vessels. So pharmacopoeia has given you freedom. You can deviate from the pharmacopoeial apparatus. So you can go with larger size vessels like extending from 2 liters to 4 liters. 4 liters generally it is used for veterinary formulations. Even you can use small volume apparatus wherein the capacity of vessel it is small, it is lower than 500 ml. So it may be 100 ml, 200 ml, so even 350 ml. So all these vessels they are available in market. But when you are going again for these small volume vessels, then in that case you must have certain justification. Generally, the small volume apparatus that is used for those drugs, they are having low dosage strengths. I'll quote here one example. When I was working in industry, I came across one product. The name of that product was calcitriol capsule. And if you look at the label claim of this calcitriol capsule, it contains just a 0.25 mcg, microgram of drug. Now imagine that if you are adding this drug 0.25 mg into a 900 ml, what will be the dilution, what will be the final concentration, and that too, the absorbance of this particular drug, it is very low. And therefore, while working on this product, we were facing a problem to do the content estimation. Even we have switched the project from UV to HPLC. We have taken certain trials on HPLC, but even HPLC was not sufficient to detect the concentration. And then we shifted to a hyphenated technique, LCMS. There we can able to detect this particular concentration. And even one more property of this product was that this is very light sensitive and unstable molecule. So in such a cases, if you have justification, you can go with smaller vessels. In a case of calcitriol, we went with the 200 or we went with small volume apparatus with capacity of 200. This is one article, very interesting article I found. It is published in International Journal of Pharmaceutics, wherein the author has conducted a very interesting study. He has used a small volume vessel of 200 capacity for the pharmacopeial, for the drug which is there in the pharmacopeia, US pharmacopeia. And he conducted the dissolution with both US pharmacopeia method, that is the standard with a 900 ml capacity, and second with small volume apparatus having a vessel capacity of 200 ml. And ultimately he found out the results. And he stated that the results which he found or obtained with modified apparatus, that is small volume apparatus with 200 ml capacity, were similar to that of what obtained with the US method, which is there in the USP. So it doesn't found a significant difference between these two methods. This is one more interesting monograph I came across, that is for the drug, a dosage from chlorzoxazone tablet. So you just look at the dissolution conditions. Clearly, under dissolution conditions in USP monograph, it is stated as a note that use 2 liter vessel for this test and the recommended volume was 1800 ml. So don't keep the misconception in your mind that only 1000 ml capacity vessels you can able to use. Now let us see some of the prerequisites, or you can call it as requirements, which one need to see or one need to fulfill before going for any type of method development. So here for dissolution method development, whatever dissolution apparatus or instrument you're going to use, that must be calibrated first. So generally there are two ways adopted for calibration of dissolution apparatus. One is mechanical way and second is chemical way. So this, under this mechanical method, you'll have to do certain physical checks or you can say physical examination. And under a chemical method, you'll have to conduct certain dissolution test. using this same dissolution apparatus. So certain dissolution calibrators, they are provided by some of the pharmacopeial agencies. So you need to use those calibrate the dissolution apparatus. Most of the times, this chemical calibration, it is also alternatively called as apparatus suitability test or even performance verification test. So I think performance verification test is the most appropriate terminology. So wherein you can do even the physical examination, that is examination of shaft, basket, paddle, vessel, and temperature, even the platform where you are putting this dissolution apparatus, that should be free from vibrations. And apart from this, whatever analytical balances you're going to use, that should be calibrated one, because most of the error, what I found, especially in academic, their basic origin is from the analytical balance. So one should be very careful while using the analytical balances. Usage should of the balance should be well controlled so that you can ensure the quality of the analytical balance. Then whatever pH meter you are using, that should be calibrated one, because most of the drugs, they are pH sensitive. Even the solubility of drug, it depends upon the pH. And if you are not taking dissolution media of appropriate pH, then obviously you're going to face problem in the drug release pattern. Apart from this, the pipettes and glassware, whatever you're going to use, those should be calibrated one. Variation of dissolution medium, this I'm going to discuss in the coming slides. Obviously, wherever you are keeping this dissolution apparatus, sufficient light should be there so that the dissolution scientist or the analytical scientist should able to see the different changes of the formulation during the dissolution process. Because these observations, they are very useful for especially for deciding the dissolution conditions. I said deaeration of the dissolution medium. This now this becomes one of the regulatory requirement, because for most of the drug products now USP it is recommending deaeration process mandatory. So we'll understand what this deaeration exactly means. See, most of the times the air bubbles, they are intact, and these air bubbles, they are sometimes they are covering the surface of your formulation product or tablet. Even sometimes they are also covering the, they are clinging to what you can say, the mesh, the pores of the mesh. But, and so because of this, what happens, so it forms a barrier around the formulation or the basket, and it sometimes hinders or creates a problem in the releasing of the drug from the dosage form. And even sometimes it also increases the buoyancy of the especially of the solid dosage forms or tablets. This may leads to increase in the dissolution rate. And sometimes because of less surface area it is exposed to the dissolution media, there may be a decrease in the release rate. Especially this problem occurs with drugs which are poorly soluble. So one has to deaerate the dissolution medium before going for the dissolution testing or before going for development or dissolution method. I'll quote here one example that is very interesting example. You must be knowing the drug, that is captopril. So the tablet formulation of this captopril, it is available in the market. This is antihypertensive drug. And this drug has a property that when it comes in contact with air, it undergoes oxidation. And therefore, there is one clear cut note. It is one clear cut note, it is written in the United States Pharmacopoeia that first you have to deaerate the dissolution medium before subjecting it to the dissolution testing. So by this way, you can avoid even the oxidation of some of the sensitive pharmaceutical ingredients. So these are some of the commonly used methodologies for degassing The first one is vacuum filtration method. So this method you can, I think, adopt in academic laboratories. Second is academic sparge. Helium sparging is there. Then automated gassing equipments, instruments, they are available in market. One of the instrument I'm going to discuss in the further slides. Then superheating also you can do. Even in certain cases, deliberately the pharmacopoeia, they are mentioning that please do not degas the media, right? And even in certain cases, if you are having a certain justification that with or without degassing, if you are proving that you are not getting any significant difference in the release pattern, so you'll have to collect this data, compile this data, and submit it to the laboratory agency for justification. Then I think you can get a green signal from the regulatory agency so then you can go ahead with the methodology without degassing. There are certain unacceptable methods also. One is nitrogen sparging and second is sonication. This is the most common procedure which is adopted in USP pharmacopoeia for degassing. So simply you will have to heat the media at 41 degrees Celsius followed by vacuum filtration through 0.45 micron filters. So I think this you can perform in the laboratory. This is the automated degasser. I think several different types of degassers they are available in the market. So one I have just picked out from the Google, that is DOSA Prep X8. So this degassing instrument, you can use it for multiple purpose. So you can use it for filtration, for mixing of the components, even for degassing purpose. So initially you will have to filter all the solutions which you or reagents which you wanted to add or use for dilution media preparation. Then second step involves mixing of those components. Third is heating, and fourth is degassing. And finally, you can able to dispense the dissolution media through this instrument. I already discussed about this captopril tablet USP monograph, wherein the note is given that completely deaerate the dissolution medium to minimize the exposure of captopril to air and analyze the sample immediately. Now let us see some more challenges which are involved in the method development process. So these are the expectation from good dissolution method or a successful dissolution method. So the first one is the dissolution method should be discriminatory. So discriminatory means it should able to differentiate, distinguish between good and bad formulation. It should able to correlate the in vivo performance of the dosage form in the body. It should be robust and rugged. It should be transferable. Transferable means, so suppose you have developed the method in the research and development center. This, if you are transferring same method to the production or in the manufacturing facility, then that should be workable over there. So it should not face any problem in manufacturing facility. So this particular process, it is called as technology transfer. And of course, there should be a controlled variability. So let us understand what do you mean by discriminatory dissolution method. So as I said in earlier slide, that you should able to differentiate between good and bad formulations. So your method should have ability to detect even the smaller changes in the drug product. I'll quote some examples over here. Let us take the example of tablet formulation. Suppose you have prepared two different tablet formulation. In one, you have incorporated just 5% of disintegrant, and in second formulation, you have incorporated 10% disintegrant. So it is but obvious that tablet formulation wherein you added 10% of disintegrant, that is more quantity of disintegrant, you should get rapid disintegration and rapid dissolution. The tablet formulation where you have added just a 5% of or lower concentration of disintegrant, there you should get the dissolution at slower rate as compared to the second formulation. So your dissolution method should be such a that it should able to differentiate two products with the two different concentration of excipients. Then and then only you can call your method as a discriminatory method. If you are getting same release pattern for both the formulation with different concentration of disintegrant, then your method is not discriminatory. You will have to do certain modifications of the method. And that is what sometimes expected, especially in pharmacopeial method. So many a times when you are going with as such pharmacopeial methods, sometimes they are even not workable, or they are not discriminatory, or they are unable to differentiate between the formulation or compositions of different quality of excipients or different quantity of excipients. So these are the different ways which one can follow to test or to check the discriminatory power of the dissolution method. So the first methodology or first way is qualitative and quantitative excipient change. I think I have put the example just now of quantitative difference of the excipient. That is what we have discussed, the example of disintegrant. Qualitatively also you can change, you can take a different formulation with different grades of excipients. Suppose in one formulation you have added IP grade excipient, in another formulation you have taken USP grade excipient, and then you have formulated and both the formulations you have tested. If you are getting significant difference, then you can say that this particular method is discriminatory method. So similarly, even you can use the manufacturing parameters. I think I have listed out around four different manufacturing parameters, but the list is not limited. Even you can go for other critical manufacturing parameters, which does have the impact on the release profile. So here I'll give quote one example. Suppose same tablet composition is there, and you are compressing it at two different compressional forces. Suppose the first formulation A, it is compressed at 3 kg per centimeter square compressional force, and the second composition you have compressed at 5 kg per centimeter square. So it is obvious that where the compressional force is high, where the hardness of the tablet is high, comparatively, you should get lower dissolution rate as compared to the tablets where the compressional force is less. So this kind of difference in the process parameters should be used to discriminate or to distinguish for developing the discriminatory method. So by using the discriminatory method, you can able to differentiate the tablet which are prepared with the low compression force from the tablet which have been prepared from the high compression force, just by looking at the dissolution profile or release pattern. This is a basic approach which is recommended by United States Pharmacopeia, especially for the development of newer pharmaceutical dosage form. So the formulator has to first check whether his drug product is it official in pharmacopeia or not. If it is official in pharmacopeia, you just go through the monograph, see whether dissolution method is there. If dissolution method is available, you just go with the same dissolution method, perform the dissolution. If you found that your method is not discriminatory, then in that case you need to modify the method. Suppose your product, it is not official in US pharmacopeia, then one more option is lying with you, and that option is you can refer the US FDA OGD site, that is Organization for Generic Drugs, wherein the FDA has created one database of the dissolution testing parameters for newly or recently incorporated drugs. So you can see that database. If the dissolution parameters are provided over there in the database, then you can select those parameters, you can conduct a dissolution, see whether your method is discriminatory or not. If that FDA recommended method is not discriminatory, you have full freedom to modify the dissolution parameter, provided that you should have proper justification that why you are deviating from the FDA recommended method or pharmacopoeia recommended method. So these are the important steps that formulation development scientist has to follow while going through the dissolution method development. So the first step is the literature survey. So wherein you'll have to thoroughly and fully understand various properties, especially physicochemical properties of drug and various physical and other properties of drug formulation. Unless and until you understand your formulation, you should not go for dissolution method. The second step, I think that I already discussed, that is selection of apparatus. This is also one of the crucial step. The third step in dissolution development, it is selection of dissolution media. This will be followed by optimization of dissolution parameters such as rotational speed, temperature, then development of suitable analytical method for estimation of content, and finally, whatever analytical method you're going to use. If it is in-house method, then you must have to go for validation. Even whatever dissolution parameters you optimize, you should have to optimize. You should have to validate those parameters. Now let us see the drug and drug product properties. So as I said earlier that before going for any method development, not just a dissolution method development, you should understand your drug and drug product, especially for active pharmaceutical ingredient. You should understand the different characteristics of drug, that includes particle size, crystal form, bulk density, solubility, and so on. Here solubility is playing a crucial and key role, especially in the development of this dissolution method. Second is drug product composition. So one must know what is the drug loading, what is the dose, then what type of dosage form, how is the design of the dosage form, what level of excipients have been added. So based on that, you can even sometimes select the dissolution media. The third thing which one should see, that is what manufacturing process. So analysts must know the manufacturing process. So I have mentioned here some of the parameters. Compressional pores, just now I also discussed one of the example of this compressional pores. Even what equipment the formulator will going to use for formulating the dosage form. Next is effect of stability storage conditions. So many a times it has been observed that some of the molecules, they are even unstable in aqueous medium. So in such a conditions, how you are going to select the dissolution media, right? So for if in advance you know, then you can take certain precautions, certain cares, you can do certain trials before going ahead for dissolution method development, especially with respect to stability of that particular drug in the aqueous media. And the last component is incompatibility of drug with certain buffers or salts. Many a times some of the drugs, they are incompatible with some of the components of the buffer or salt what we are using for the preparation of dissolution media. So in that, if you'll refer even British Pharmacopoeia, for the same pH buffer, you can get the different compositions. So in BP, British Pharmacopoeia, you'll get several different composition for the preparation of same pH buffers. So if one buffer composition is not suitable, even you have alternative to go with another official buffers with different salts. Now here I have summarized some of the ideal qualities of dissolution media. So it should meet the sink condition, that is what the prime requirement. So whatever dissolution volume you are selecting, that should be based on the saturation solubility of the drug. That anyway I am going to discuss in the upcoming slides. The next important point is whatever dissolution media you are choosing, that should be simple to prepare as far as possible. So it should not be very critical. Then third, whatever product you have selected for the testing, that should be stable in the selected dissolution media. And as far as possible, you should limit the use of surfactants. And even sometimes the alcohol is recommended, especially you should restrict the use of alcohol just to study the dose damping studies. Whatever media you are selecting, that should be bio-relevant for the appropriate site. So I quoted some example here for immediate release tablet. Quickly you can go with acidic media. For delayed release type of formulation, you can go with the initial screening. It is done in acidic media followed by the neutral media. Here I have slide, you can see one diagram wherein four different important parts of the body or sites of the body are specified. One is mouth, second is small intestine, third one is the stomach, and fourth one is colon. So the selection of your dissolution media, the especially the pH selection, that you will have to decide based on where especially you are targeting the drug. Suppose your formulation is mouth dissolving tablet or mouth dissolving film is there, then you must have to do or conduct the dissolution in the pH ranging between pH 5 to 7, since the pH of the saliva is lying in that particular range. Similarly, for stomach, you need to go with the pH between 1 to 3. So here, both the fasting as well as fed condition, you should take into consideration. And I think acid buffers generally of having pH 2.1 and 1.2, they are recommended for conducting the dissolutions. And this, I already said, it is applicable to immediate release type of dosage forms. The dosage form which you are targeting in small intestine, especially the delayed release type of formulation, so which are unstable in stomach, but they are releasing their drug in the intestine. So in such a cases, you need to conduct the dissolution in two different stages, first in acid stage, followed by the alkaline stage, wherein pH should be in between 6 to 7.5, and likewise for colon also. These are some of the recommendations given in most of the standard references and even in some of the pharmacopoeia. For the drugs which belongs to a category of BCS class 1 and BCS class 3, those belongs to, you can call these drugs as highly soluble drugs. So for such a drugs, you can go with the simple aqueous media with or without enzymes. Especially if you wanted to select the dissolution media for those drugs which are falling under the BCS class 2 and class 4. So here the drug is especially having low solubility or poor solubility. So it is recommended that you should go with the bio-relevant medias such as simulated gastric fluid, simulated intestinal fluid, and even sometimes you can go for simulated salivary fluid. If your drug is entirely new, you don't know the solubility of drug, then your first step in the selection of dissolution media is to determine the solubility of the drug in the different medias. So here I recommended one method which I found in the literature, that is shaken glass method, wherein you are going to determine the saturation solubility of the drug at 37 degrees Celsius. And apart from this, several methods are available in the literature. Those even you can use for determination of solubility. One of the important parameter which one need to determine, especially in case of new drugs, and I think this kind of study, it is also done during the discovery itself when the API is synthesized and it is subjected to characterization. That intrinsic dissolution is done. So through this intrinsic dissolution, we can get a lot of information. So let us understand what is this intrinsic dissolution. So intrinsic dissolution is defined as the dissolution of a pure drug substance from a specified constant surface area. So for determination of this intrinsic dissolution, you are going to use the same dissolution apparatus with some special holder in place of paddle. So you will have to prepare one small mini tablet of the active pharmaceutical ingredient using special punch and dye. So this mini tablet, you will going to compress it, you will going to prepare it, and you will put it into the holder. I think I have shown here in the diagram. This is what the punch and dye which are used, and here one holder is placed. In that holder, you will going to put this tablet, and you will subject. You will fit this holder into the place of paddle, and you will run the dissolution in the specified dissolution media. And then you will calculate, or you will find out the intrinsic dissolution based on the release of the drug in the specified dissolution media. So by doing this intrinsic dissolution, you can get information about the solubility of the drug. And not just the solubility of the drug, you just look at the different values which I have specified here. So if the intrinsic dissolution rate is lower than 0.1 mg per minute per centimeter square, so that means the bioavailability will be determined by dissolution rate. If it is higher than 1 mg per minute per centimeter square, so this indicates that the bioavailability is permeability dependent, or will be determined by the drug permeability. So such a valuable information related to dissolution and permeability, you can able to get through this intrinsic dissolution. Next is pH dependent solubility. So as what I discussed in the solubility slide, so especially for new drugs, you'll have to do the or determine the solubility in different pH medium, having the pH in the physiological range, that is between pH 1.2 to 7.5. Not just you'll have to determine the solubility of drug in this particular medium, but along with this, you should also determine the stability of the drug, because of course, as I stated, in the ideal qualities of the media, that whatever drug you are, whatever media you are selecting, in that media, your drug should be stable for longer period of time. Next is sink condition. So as I already mentioned, again, I'll just repeat it. The sink condition may be defined as volume of dissolution medium with or without a solubilizer or surfactants needed to provide complete dissolution of expected amount of drug present in the drug. So the selection of dissolution volume, it is very, very important. If your selection is not appropriate, then you're going to face the problem in the dissolution process, because if the selected volume, it is insufficient, if it is getting saturated by the release drug itself, then that will hinder the process of release of drug from the dosage form. So further release will get stopped and you unable to quantify it accurately. So generally the volume of medium should be at least three times that required in order to form a saturated solution. So this is what the criteria one must to follow while selecting the volume of dissolution media. Those drugs which are not meeting the sink condition, so in that case we'll have freedom to use the different solubilizers or surfactant, so as to increase the solubility of the drug in the dissolution medium. Right, so if you are getting appropriate dissolution or expected solubility in the selected volume of dissolution, then I think you can go with the typical size or what you can say, small size or typical size, which is recommended by the monograph of the vessel. Okay. These are the rules of thumb which one need to keep in mind while selecting the concentration of surfactant or while selecting the surfactant. So whatever surfactant basically you are selecting, as I said, you should have justification why you are going to select that particular surfactant for this particular media, for this particular product or drug, right? So unless and until that drug is having low solubility, you should not use solubilizers or surfactant. Otherwise, it will be very difficult to convince to the regulatory agency. Secondly, you need to justify even why you have chosen this particular concentration of surfactant. So for this purpose, you will have to conduct several trials ranging from lower concentration of the surfactant to higher concentration of the surfactant in the dissolution media. So you will have to conduct the dissolution in different media, in the same media with a different concentration of surfactant. You'll have to compile this data, collect this data, analyze this data, and based on that, you can decide the level of the surfactant. It is generally recommended that the concentration of surfactant that should be lower as far as possible, should be lesser than 1%, even though the higher limit we can go up to 2% level, but it's better to limit the use of surfactants because unnecessarily you will have to go for some more scrutiny. Here I have put that if it is more than 1%, you require greater scrutiny. If it is more than 1.5%, sometimes even it is very difficult to handle such a type of dissolution media. You must have even experience in case of sodium lauryl sulfate. When the concentration is higher, you'll get formation of large quantity of foam, and then it becomes difficult to even measure the exact amount of dissolution media in that case because of the interference of the foam. And last one, which is very important, especially in media selection, that stay within pH 1.1 to pH 7.5 if at all possible. So this is the recommendation by most of the pharmacopoeia, that you'll have to follow the use the pH of the dissolution media in the physiological range. But I have even referred some of the pharmacopoeia. One case I have identified in British pharmacopoeia, wherein a well-known product is the drug is the isotretinoin. This drug, it is a very light sensitive drug. For conducting the dissolution of this product, isotretinoin capsule, the British pharmacopoeia has suggested borate buffer. You know that the pH of the borate buffer, it is around 8 to 9. So obviously there is some justification for selection of this particular. So you can deviate even from the pH value, whatever specified there in the pharmacopoeia or in the standard reference book, provided that you should have certain justification. In case of isotretinoin, that drug molecule, it is very unstable in even neutral media and even acidic media. And therefore, they have selected borate buffer, which is having pH around 8 to 9. Otherwise, you can go with different buffers having pH 1.2, 2.1, those falling under the category of acidic buffer. 4.5, 5.5, those are acetate buffer, and 6.8 and 7.5, those are falling under the category of phosphate buffers. These are some of the examples of excipient. This list I have taken it from US Pharmacopoeia. You can get it from there. So there are different types of surfactants which you can use, which includes anionic, cationic, non-ionic, and deuterium. So the selection of surfactant especially depend upon the nature and the chemistry of the drug. Next is use of enzymes. So many a times, even Pharmacopoeia itself, it is recommending the use of enzyme in the routine dissolution media. The reason is that, especially in case of the formulations like soft gelatin capsule, hard gelatin capsule, or the drug product, especially the tablets which are coated by using gelatin. So therein, this gelatin, it is having a property of cross-linking. And this cross-linking especially, it hinders the release of drug from the dosage form. So to avoid this cross-linking, sometimes the pharmacopoeial agencies, they are recommending addition of certain kind of enzymes. Even you can go with the products wherein you are using gelatin as an excipient or as a component of your dosage form. These are also some of the agents you can add, that is anti-foaming agent and antioxidants. Anti-foaming agent, especially where you are getting more quantity of foam and this foam is interfering in the dissolution process. So therefore, to disperse the foam, you can add even anti-foaming agents like cimethicone or even N-octanol. When you are going for N-octanol, you will have to limit the concentration of N-octanol. Sometimes the ascorbic acid is added because in certain cases the drug particle or drug itself is very sensitive to oxidation process. In that case, you can add ascorbic acid as a stabilizer. These are some of the cautions you need to take while selecting water as a dissolution media. You should be very careful when you are going with water as a dissolution media. I'll recommend it's better not to use water as a dissolution media because water doesn't have a buffering capacity. So when you are collecting water from different sources, obviously the composition of water changes, and you'll also experience even in your laboratory that when you are collecting the water from the different sources, you'll get a different value of pH for the different water samples. So this especially posing the problem in case where your drug, it is sensitive to a slight change in the pH. Most of the times, even the solubility of the drug, it is what you can say, pH dependent. So in that cases, you're going to face the problem. And therefore, as far as possible, you try to avoid the water as a dissolution medium. Wherever it is specified in the pharmacopoeia to use water as a dissolution medium, every time whenever you are using, please check the pH at the start of the dissolution process. One more thing I have mentioned on this slide, that is, do not use SLS with potassium phosphate buffer since it is incompatible. So whenever you are using sodium lauryl sulfate as a surfactant, you must use sodium phosphate as a buffer for the preparation of media. Now let us discuss about some of the other parameters which are important in setting the conditions of dissolution apparatus. So one of them is agitation rate. So this agitation rate or stirring rate, or you can call it as RPM, revolution per minute, or rotational speed. So it should be sufficient to allow the media to interact with dosage form. So whenever it is specified, whenever this number is specified in pharmacopoeia, you please stick to this number. If you are decreasing or increasing this number, you'll have to give proper justification that why you are deviating from the specified value of the RPM. Commonly, for almost all the dissolution equipments, you can see that pharmacopoeia has already provided the range. So you'll have to use the rotational speed in that particular range. If you are going out of that range, again, you'll have to use justification to the regulatory authorities. Especially in case of cooning, whenever you are getting cooning at the bottom of the paddle, there you can sometimes go with the change in the revolution speed, especially for paddles. Next is setting the temperature for the dissolution testing. So the standard temperature which is recommended for oral solid dosage form, that is 37 degrees Celsius. For suppositories, we'll have to go with slightly increased temperature, that is around 38 degrees Celsius. For transdermal patches or products, and even for topical ointments, we'll have to go with slightly lower temperature, that is around 32 degrees Celsius. So the selection of temperature, again, it depends upon the kind of dosage form, where especially you are targeting your dosage form, and what is its route of administration. So based on that, you're going to decide or select the appropriate temperature condition. So it is mandatory that, especially from regulatory point of view, that you should take at least, you should note down the temperature before starting the dissolution process and at the end of dissolution process. Now, how to set the dissolution time duration? So especially for immediate release formulations or tablets which are having dissolution more than 85%, just in 15 minutes, there you can go with single time point, that is 15 minutes. So where the rate of release that is more than 85, it is less than 85% in 15 minutes, in that case, you can go for multiple time points, that includes 20 minutes, 30 minutes, 45 minutes, or even 60 minutes. Even you can go beyond 60 minutes also if you refer US pharmacopoeia, especially for dissolution of artemether product tablets. So therein, the dissolution, it is carried out in two different tiers. So in first hour, the expected release is of 40%, and in second hour, the expected release is of 60%. Since this drug, it is highly insoluble in the water. And because of this, the two time points have been set. First is at first at the end of first hour, and second is at the end of second hour. Even the limit of drug release, what is set at the second time point, it is just 60%. Otherwise, we are going with the 80% of the label claim value. For suspension, even you can go with the earlier time points like 5 minutes, 10 minutes. For delayed release tablets, we'll have to conduct the dissolution for at least 2 hours in acidic media. And then you can have some more multiple points in the buffer media. For extended release, minimum we'll have to keep the three time points. The first is the initial first and second hours, where you will come to know the information pertaining to the dose dumping, if it is there to your formulation. The second will be the intermediate point that will define the in vitro profile of the drug. And the third is the final point, which will indicate the complete release of the drug from the dosage form. So if you look at the dissolution profiles in the different articles, even you can get more than three time points also for extended release formulation. But it is mandatory to have at least 3 points to conduct the dissolution of extended release formulations. Now, when to add dosage form? Most of the times, the students are in confusion that exactly at what point you'll have to add dosage form. So there are two usual methods which are used. One is manual method, where the plates are not provided in the dissolution vessels, or the sampling space is not provided in the dissolution vessel, right? And the second way is automatic way, where that is available especially in auto samplers. So the dosage form may be introduced simultaneously or sequentially, but they must be introduced into non-rotating media. So this care we'll have to take. So before starting your dissolution apparatus, you'll have to at the tablets or dosage form. So how to handle the dosage form? This is what the recommended method to handle the dosage form, because most of the times if you are not using gloves or forceps, there may be chances that scratches may take place, or there may occur some damage to the surface of the formulation or product. At the same time, when you are handling the formulation, so you'll have to observe the integrity of the formulation or product. You'll have to see the surface, or you'll have to see whether is there any defect in the tablet or a dosage form, whichever you have selected for conducting the distribution. This is one more very important step, weighing of the sample. Even though you are not using anywhere in dissolution calculation the weight of the capsule or tablet, especially the weighing of the dosage form or tablet is useful during the drug development or formulation development stage. Because many a times, as I said earlier also, that because of weight variation also you are getting different release pattern, or even different dissolution results. So this data will be helpful to you, especially in investigation. If some times your dissolution is failing. Next is sinkers. So sinkers, especially, they are used for floating type of dosage forms, and even sometimes your conventional dosage form, if it contains low density polymers or low density excipients, so there also you will find that some of the dosage from some of the tablets, they are floating. So to sink the tablet at the bottom of the vessel, you'll have to use the sinkers. Even in certain cases like capsules, sometimes paddle type of apparatus is recommended. So in that case, you'll have to enclose that capsule into the sinker, and then you'll have to add the sample into the dissolution vessel. Now these sinkers, they are available. They are of a different type, and they are available in the market. Some of them you can even fabricate in your laboratory itself. You'll have to use the platinum wire and cork bore of the desired specification, which is there in the United States Pharmacopoeia. Keep in mind that whatever sinker you are using, that should not be too tight, so that it will restrict the disintegration of the formulation, or it should not be too loose that immediately that tablet or that formulation will come out from the sinker. And as I said, that you can get the specification for different kind of sinkers, and even nowadays stainless steel sinkers, they are available in the market, and even they are provided by or recommended by some of the pharmacopeia agencies. These are the specification for some standard sinkers which are there in the USP. Again, I'm saying that don't restrict to what the specification have been mentioned here by the USP. If your formulation is not fitting to the requirement, whatever specified in the USP, you are free to design your own sinkers. Again, you'll have to give the justification. These are the typical observation which the student has to do while conducting or while developing the dissolution method. So first is after putting the formulation or dosage form into the dissolution vessel, you will have to see that how is the distribution of the particle, whether that tablet, it falls, it is at the center of the vessel, or it is at the side of the vessel. Whether the particles, they are floating on the surface of the dissolution media, or they are sinking at the bottom, they are forming coning at the bottom, or is there any air bubble formation around the surface of the tablet, or around the surface of the mesh. So whether your tablet, is it dancing or spinning? So all these, whether the formulation or product is heated by paddle. So if such a situation is there, then obviously you will have to exchange or modify certain things in your dissolution apparatus. Even you'll have to see how much time your formulation or dosage form it has taken to disintegrate, especially for immediate or fast disintegrating tablets, or even for conventional tablets also. Even for coated tablets, you'll have to see, especially for entry coated tablets, wherein in the initial phase you are conducting the dissolution in acidic media. So you'll have to see that in 2 hours whether that coat has been removed or it remains intact. Because this also gives certain indications whether our product is of good quality or bad quality. Because especially for entry coated tablet, if that coat of tablet it dissolves itself in the acidic media, then obviously the drug will release from that dosage form, and your product will fail to meet the pharmacopeial specification. And these are some of the usual remedies. So depending upon the observation, we can use different kind of remedies. So you can change the type of apparatus. Even you can change the speed of vegetation. As I said, in case of pruning, if you are getting pruning at 50 RPM, you can even increase the speed of the RPM so that you can get rid from this particular problem. Even if you are getting air bubbling, air is entrapping, then you can go for deaeration. If your formulation product is floating, if it is hitting with the paddle, you can go with the sinker. So likewise, you can do certain modifications based on the observation. So these observations, they are very, very important. Many a times I have observed that students, they are simply putting the tablet in the dissolution media and they are leaving it. And they are coming when they have to do the sampling. So this is the wrong practice. The next point is how to do the sampling from the dissolution vessel. So I think the specifications related to this or recommendation related to this given in almost all the pharmacopoeias, you'll have to do the sampling, especially at the halfway between the top of the paddle or basket and the media. So this is the right position where you'll have to do the sampling. Whenever you are doing the sampling, that pipette should not be closer than 1 centimeter to the wall of the vessel. So these are certain recommendations given by pharmacopoeia. But nowadays, this problem doesn't arise, especially in industry, because they are having auto samplers. So sampling is done automatically, and all the specification they have set itself, they have set in the instrument itself. Okay. And the last point that is very, very important, that is analytical method. So once you are done with dissolution, will have to remove the aliquots at certain time interval, and those dissolution sample one need to analyze it to determine the amount of drug which is released at that particular time interval. So for doing this, you'll have to take the help of certain analytical instruments like UV, HPLC, UPLC, or even in certain cases you may have to go to more sensitive instruments or more sophisticated instruments, or you can call it hyphenated instruments like LCMS. So the selection of this instrument, again, that depends upon the chemistry of the drug, how much absorbance it is showing at a lambda max, then whether is it having chromophores or not, or at what concentration it is showing how much absorbance, whether it is showing sufficient absorbance so as to do the quantitation by just using UV spectrophotometer. So depending on that, you're going to choose the instrument. So that depends entirely on the concentration of the drug, on the chemistry of the drug. So on this basis, you can select the appropriate instrument. So first preference should be given to the UV, because it is less time consuming as compared to HPLC. If it is not workable on UV, then you can go for HPLC. Then you can, if the dissolution time is more, generally you'll have to set the runtime in HPLC very less, max to max 4 to 5 minutes, because this is because when you are doing dissolution profiling around 36 or 30 or more than that samples you'll have to analyze. So just imagine if your runtime is 30 minutes or 1 hour for one sample, each sample you'll have to inject in duplicate. So how much time it will take to just analyze the profile of one batch. So therefore, the selection of appropriate equipment, analytical instrument for content determination, that becomes challenging. One has to take care, one has to take into consideration the time that it should take less time, at the same time that methodology of that instrument that should be sensitive, that should able to detect the concentration in, that should able to detect even the lower concentration of the drug sample. In the analytical method development, one more thing is very important, especially in the sample preparation, the filtration of sample. So when you are withdrawing the sample, you are subjecting it to the filtration process. Many a times it happens that sometimes the drug, the formulation itself contains very low quantity of drug. As I have taken the example of that calcitriol, it contains calcitriol capsule. It contains just a 0.25 mcg of drug. So in that case, if you are filtering the solution of this drug through the Wattmann filter paper, I think it will get absorbed on that filter paper itself. So you won't get proper dissolution results after, or proper what you can say, drug content result after analysis. So in that case, you'll have to select the proper method of filtration. So apart from Wattmann filter paper, you can use the nylon filter paper of different pore size ranging from 0.2 to 0.45 micron. Even syringe filters, they are available in market, those you can use, but they are costlier. And I think it's difficult, especially for academic institution. So at least you should go with good quality Wattmann paper so that you can avoid the problems which are especially you are facing with the filtration. And not just this, you'll have to the same sample you'll have to analyze, centrifuge it and then analyze it so that you'll come to know that whether filter paper is it absorbing some of the drug or not, or whatever filter you have chosen that is absorbing a drug or not. Right, so you can filter the sample. One is filtered sample and one is unfiltered, that is centrifuge sample. For both these samples, you will determine the drug content. If they are same or there is no significant difference, then you can go ahead with whatever filter you have used. So that is what it is called as filter validation. So you'll have to do the filter validation, you'll have to do a sensitive method, you'll have to avoid more processing of the sample. And if your method is completely novel, completely new, then in that case, you'll have to validate the method for different validation parameters like specificity, accuracy, precision, ruggedness, and so on. I think you'll get information pertaining to all these validation parameters from most of the previously published literature, or even you can refer ICS guidelines, or even you can refer USP guidelines. And obviously, time of processing, time of analysis, it is low. If you are going with a less sophisticated instrument like UV, then the cost of analysis will be less. These are the once you optimize the parameters, once you develop the methods, so these are certain final requirements that the method should meet. So your method, whatever you have developed, that should have low variability at the initial time points, max to max 20% of variation is allowed. In the latter points, about maximum 10% of variation is allowed. So your methodology, whatever you have developed, that should meet this particular requirement. There should be complete release of drug. At least it should be more than 85%. And as I said, there should be proper understanding of dissolution release. whatever methodology you have developed, this is very, very important that it should be discriminatory. It should be able to differentiate, distinguish good and bad formulation. And finally, the dissolution parameter, dissolution conditions, and your analytical and the developed analytical method that should be robust, rugged, and reproducible. This is one article which I've published in a very good journal, that is International Journal of Spectroscopy. It is published by Hindavi. It is one of the Scopus Index journal. So wherein we have done development and validation of discriminatory dissolution method for oral formulation of saccharinated sulfur. This is one more article that is development and validation of a novel reverse phase HPLC method for estimation of low salt and potassium in dissolution samples of immediate and sustained release tablets. So you can refer these two articles for developing both dissolution method as well as analytical method for estimation. And now it's time to conclude my presentation. So I just wanted to give some concluding remarks. So in vitro dissolution is the best tool, available tool as on today, which can at least quantitatively assure about the biological availability of the drug. There is huge scope, huge space for research in the development of newer dissolution technology, even new methods, even pharmacopeial monographs. If you look at the different pharmacopoeias and the drugs which are there in the pharmacopoeia, you'll get several newer drugs till date which are not official in pharmacopoeia. For them, there is scope for development of dissolution method. Even whatever methodology is provided in pharmacopoeia itself, sometimes it is not workable, sometimes it is not up to the mark. So there also you can do certain developments, and you can recommend certain changes to even pharmacopoeial agencies, provided that whatever trials, whatever data, whatever experiments you have done should be authenticated one. And those should able to justify that the pharmacopoeial, this particular method, it is far, far better than whatever recommended in the pharmacopoeial monograph. So there should be a systematic and scientific approach always for any type of development, not just an dissolution method development. Nowadays, robotics and machine learning and even artificial intelligence is also having, I think, a lot of scope. Anyway, I think after me, Dr. Parag Gede sir will going to discuss this in more detail, but it is also having, I think, more scope in dissolution testing and dissolution method developments. And at the end, talk about this academic standards or academic research standards. I just wanted to say that basic infrastructure, facilities, sophisticated instrument, positive efforts, positive attitude, and honesty is the need of time to improve the quality of research in the academia. So with this, these are certain guidelines which I have referred. So these guidelines, they are openly available in the Google database. You can refer these. And with this, I'm ending my session. Now the session is open for a question and answer. So thank you very much to all of you for listening my talk. So patiently.
Thank you so much, sir, for the very informative session. There are a few questions which have been asked by the participants. The first one is from Ms. Lalita. What are the various challenges and regulatory standards for dissolution of herbal formulations?
For herbal formulation, the first challenge is selection of marker compound. Because most of the times you will see especially the formulations which are multi-component formulation. So in that case, it is very difficult to choose or select one particular phytoconstituent as a standard or marker to decide the quality of that formulation. So this is one challenge, and the second challenge will be there, that is in setting up this specification for dissolutions. So in that case, one has to, as recently we will refer even the recent regulations, Dragon Cosmetic Act, even the one more new terminology has been incorporated, that is for phytopharmaceuticals. There they have clearly mentioned that at least you should at least there should be minimum 4 phytoconstituents which are qualitatively and quantitatively defined. So whichever formulation are there wherein they contains phytopharmaceutical or phytopharmaceutical extract, so I think you can take those phytoconstituent as a standard and go ahead for further standardization process, or you can go ahead for even dissolution of such a formulations.
Okay, sir, thank you. Next question is from Mr. Paresh Mahaparle. What is the significance of discriminating dissolution method?
I think I discussed a lot about discriminatory methods. Most importantly, that when the same formulation you are preparing using a different quality of excipients or different quantity of excipient, then you should able to come. You should able to come to know that you should able to differentiate those formulation based on the dissolution testing. That is what I can say, because I can give a lot of example, but since time constraint is there, so, and I already discussed this throughout my presentation.
Okay, sir. Thank you for such an informative session. Now I would like to hand over the session to Ms. Heta.
So once again, thank you to organizing committee, to Mr. Pritam Zohadkar, Dr. Sanket Darashukar sir, and principals of both the colleges for giving me this opportunity to interact with
you. Thank you very much, sir, for informative session, sir.
Thank you very much, sir, for your valuable time.
Thank you.
Now,
sir,
I would like to invite our next speaker. Our next speaker for the day is Dr. Parag Gide. Dr. Parag Gide is currently working as a principal of Dr. L. H. Hiranandani College of Pharmacy. Sir has over 23 years of explicit knowledge in pharmaceutical analysis and has worked with Bharati Vidyapeeth's College of Pharmacy and MET's Institute of Pharmacy previously. He has guided over 17 postgraduate students in specializations of quality assurance and pharmaceutical chemistry. His main area of research include bioanalytical method development and validation, development and validation of stability indicating assay methods, microwave assisted synthesis and degradation, impurity profiling of active pharmaceutical ingredients, application of machine learning and in pharmaceutical sciences. Sir has received various university approvals as research guide at UG, PG and PhD levels from renowned universities in the specialization of quality assurance and pharmaceutical chemistry. Sir has also received various university research grants and is a reviewer of research papers on pharmaceutical analysis for Indian Journal of Pharmaceutical Sciences and Journal of Chromatographic Science. He has also delivered various seminars and guest lectures as a resource person in pharmaceutical analysis. Sir has 18 research publications in various national and international journals. Sir has a lifetime membership of Association of Pharmaceutical Teachers of India, APTI, and Indian Pharmaceutical Association. Sir, I welcome you to the session and hand over the session to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for the kind introduction. Hello, everyone. I'm really, really happy to be a part of this FDP. I wish to thank Dr. Mohan Kale and the organizing committee of the FDP to give me this opportunity to talk about a subject which has become one of my favorite topics in the recent times. Now, there were two or three reasons for specifically choosing this particular topic for this FDP. The first reason was that 2-3 years ago, when I was machine learning, AI, Internet of Things, and such other terms were coming in vogue, this particular term sort of intrigued me. It was a strange term. Generally, we expect learning to be a human domain. How can we get machines to learn, basically? And with this intrigue came a lot of interest. And I felt that you all must also be probably feeling this curiosity about what exactly is machine learning. That was the first reason for choosing machine learning. Next was the timing of this FDP. It is during a lockdown, and in the near future, we are looking at a new normal, where our MPharm students probably will not be able to spend so much time in laboratories. Then, under these circumstances, faculty members who are PG guides will be looking at avenues where they can extend their research interests. Machine learning can be one of those avenues. So with these thoughts, I felt that I will choose this application of machine learning in QBD as the topic of the discussion for today. Naturally, because the reasons were such, most emphasis in this talk will be given on machine learning, what it is exactly, how do we get machines to learn, with little bit touch upon will be given to QBD aspect of machine learning. Let me just highlight the contents of today's discussion. Before we start with machine learning, I guess we should understand what is the meaning of learning and get some insight about what is human learning. Okay, what is this incredible thing which happens when humans learn? After that, I will be dwelling on limitations of human learning, and that will be the right time to actually extend the discussion to machine learning, how it can overcome the limitations of human learning. In machine learning specifically, I will be devoting around 20 minutes for the gradient descent algorithm. This algorithm happens to be the most popular, most common algorithm in machine learning, in artificial intelligence. In fact, a lot of applications of machine learning and AI rely on gradient descent algorithm or its modification or advanced version of gradient descent algorithm. And lastly, I'll be just talking about two or three applications where gradient descent can help us in performing QBD and pharmaceutical research. So let's start with the first aspect. What is learning? Actually, this term has been used in such a casual manner that we have started using the term interchangeably or alternatively with words like understanding, education, knowledge gaining. But actually, the word learning has got some specific definition. Out of the many definitions that were available, I have written down two. First is, it is a process that leads to change, which occurs as a result of experience and increases the potential of improved performance and future learning. Now, this definition is a lot, you know, a lot of things in one sentence. Don't bother about it. The second definition is what actually creates a lot of interest. It is a very precise, simple definition. Learning involves strengthening of correct responses and weakening of incorrect responses. This is actually what human learning is all about. The next slide will make this particular definition of learning a bit more clearer. This is a very popular and very commonplace scenario in all homes. You see, what is happening is a child is being trained, or rather a child is learning to identify objects. Now, generally, the parents won't put the child in front of a guest and directly ask, identify this object. No, that is not going to happen. For that, first learning has to take place. And for learning to take place, the child has to be trained. The child has to be trained. How is it trained? First, the mother or father sits with a book, shows the child some objects. Let us say an apple is being shown. And the words, this is an apple, this is an apple, is repeated so many times. When this trial is taking place, what happens in the child's brain is, it takes in all these inputs. We call these as features. The red color, the shape of the apple, the sound which accompanies this training exercise, that is apple, apple, apple. And after this training is over, the child is asked by the parent, point or identify apple in this collection of objects. The child attempts to do that. And what does it use? It uses the features which were the input variables earlier. In the first trial, probably the child does not get it right. And when that happens, the mother or father shows a little bit of disapproval, affectionately though, and says, no, this is not the apple. And they again point it out. And that is where the second trial begins. The second training begins. Something miraculous happens. Even in this, at this very, very early age, something happens in the brain of that child, which goes on improving the predictions which the child does. That is, the actual response of the child, the prediction of the child starts getting closer and closer to the actual answer. And that is what is happening in learning. That is what takes place. And after many such trials, you'll observe that the predictions and the actual object is very close to each other. Now, many a times you will observe that if a tomato is placed or tomato photograph is shown to the child, he might mistake or she might mistake it for an apple. That is because the child unknowingly puts a lot of emphasis on color and puts less emphasis on the shape and other features. I will come to this particular point in the later slides. This is another example, learning to drive. Those who have actually learned to drive, you'll recollect in the earlier days when you were trying to negotiate a bend, you were using several features. You were using several features like, or input variables like the turning of the steering wheel, application of brake, easing on the accelerator. Sometimes you have to change the gear as well. All these features are being used to some extent. You have to decide how much you're going to turn the steering wheel, how much brake you're going to apply. This is what is called as the feature selection. You are selecting quantities of the features. And what are you doing? You are predicting at that time that by selecting these features, whatever you have selected, you will be able to negotiate the turn properly. But what actually happens in the first trial? The actual response becomes different. You might end up going in the wrong direction. Either you take a lesser turn or you take a larger turn. The reason again is because you have put improper emphasis on different features. Probably you felt that the steering wheel is very important. So you put emphasis on the steering wheel, but did not put any emphasis on the brake or the accelerator. And because of that, things did not turn out the way you predicted them to be. Now, what happens after this is, because the predicted and the actual response was different, you call this as error. Sometimes in machine learning, it is called as cost. Then you did further attempts. And during these attempts, what did you do? You did not repeat the same things that you did first time. You changed the input variables slightly. Put different emphasis on the steering wheel, the brake, the accelerator. And it turned out that slowly your predicted response and your actual response were very close to each other and you were able to negotiate the bend properly. You can just read through this. Till now, what we have seen is learning involves trials, training. Okay. In each trial, there are input variables or features. The learner uses these features in certain amounts based on his assumptions, his gut feeling, and predicts a response. Then he gets an actual response for the trial. Because there is a difference in the actual response and predicted response, which we call as an error or cost, he makes mental adjustments. And that is what is the miraculous thing. He makes mental adjustments without anybody telling him to do so. And gradually, as the number of trials progresses, the errors become lesser and lesser, and your actual response becomes close to the predicted response. This is the penultimate example of human learning. After this, I am going to take just one more example of human learning before proceeding to machine learning. Here, I have shown a young girl, and she is learning to make tea. She has got some predicted flavor, some target flavor which she has in mind. And what she is actually going to get is the actual flavor. The first time she tries to make the tea, she uses these inputs. I have already told you that inputs are features. Tea powder, sugar, milk, ginger. Mind well, although these examples are nowhere related to pharmaceuticals, all these examples are important for your understanding of the concept of machine learning. So please be with me. These are the actual inputs or features, the tea powder, sugar, milk, ginger. And these are what are called as features. She makes the tea, selecting some quantity of tea powder, some quantity of sugar, milk, ginger, which she feels will be able to give her the proper flavor of tea. That is her predicted flavor. Predicted output. And naturally, she does not want to make bad tea. So her predicted output is good flavor. But since this is her first time, she ends up making, let us say, bitter tea. Now, naturally, why has this happened? It has happened because the quantities which she has selected are not in sync, are not proper. Now, why she has selected improper quantities, we'll come to that later on. And we can just relate this to tablet making examples where the features are going to be different. They are not going to be naturally tea powder, sugar, but they are going to be disintegrant, lubricant, binder, so on and so forth. So you'll be able to apply all these things later on. This is the error, the bitter tea difference of the bitter tea from the good flavored tea. And I'm telling you, we call this as cost. She does not give up. She makes a second attempt, third attempt, fourth attempt, fifth attempt, and like that, many, many attempts. We call that as training examples. And how many training examples are possible? We just give you that arbitrary value, M. So after M training examples, you'll observe that the tea goes on becoming better and better and better. The actual flavor and the predicted flavor sort of start matching each other. And that is the point where she can put her skills to test, her learning to test. That is, she'll be able to serve tea to some guests or some other person with confidence that her predicted flavor will be good. It will be equal to the actual flavor. We are just one short of that intuition. What is exactly happening? Why is the learner making these changes? And naturally, these changes are in the features. Okay, now that will be clear in this slide. That young girl knows that the flavor is some function of the input variables, tea powder, water, milk, and sugar. She also knows that each of these ingredients has got some contributory power to the ultimate flavor. Okay, she knows it has got some contributory power. We will call that contributory power as theta. So how many thetas will be there? Since there are four ingredients over here, tea powder, milk, sugar, and water, there will be four contributory powers, different theta values. And this theta, pharmacists will know this as coefficient. So for example, here it will be coefficient of flavor associated with tea powder. That is, it can be thought as flavor per unit gram of the tea powder. So that the overall contribution of any ingredient will be this coefficient, will be this coefficient multiplied by the quantity of that ingredient. And now, this is something which has happening in our mind. You see, mentally she multiplies the coefficient with the quantity of water which she selects, this coefficient with the tea powder and this coefficient with the sugar, so on and so forth, and ultimately predicts the flavor. If the predicted flavor and the actual flavor does not match, I had taken the example bitter tea. Now, why did she end up getting, this is critical, so pay attention. Why did she end up getting bitter tea? Naturally, because she added more tea powder. Why did she add more tea powder? It was not her intention. It is because somewhere in the back of her, she is questioning the contributory power of the tea powder. She has taken a lower estimate of this coefficient. And because this coefficient is small, she has taken more tea powder, ending up with a bitter tea. If the taste is watery, what has happened is she has probably underestimated the power of water to the taste, and ended up adding, to compensate that, she has ended up adding more water. And although I am explaining this to you, this is happening in the girl's mind in a subconscious manner. That is why human learning is so complex. It is happening in a subconscious manner. But it is happening. So what she does is, she changes these coefficients, she changes these weightages subconsciously without knowing it, and makes the necessary adjustments. That is, because she has underestimated the tea powder earlier, she has increased the tea powder quantity. Now she will say, no, it is powerful. So she decreases the tea powder quantity. Probably she increases the water for the bitter taste, increases the milk also, maybe sugar also she will increase a bit, and make necessary adjustment in these theta values, perform the further training examples. Each training example, she makes small adjustments in her understanding of these theta values. All this is happening subconsciously. But ultimately, what happens is, after 10-15 trials, she gets a good taste of tea. I hope I am clear enough. Now we'll move to the pharmaceutical example. What we have understood at this juncture is, basically human learning is about adjusting the coefficient values of these input variables. Please make a note of this. Automatic adjustments of theta values, parameters or weights associated with the input variables, that is the features. Now, when we take this pharmaceutical example, it will be further clearer. A fresh pharmacy graduate is posed with a problem of making tablets having acceptable hardness of, let us say, 6 to 8 kilograms per centimeter square. Okay. And this is the first time he is making the tablets. And since we don't want to complicate the things, although there are many, many features associated with making tablets of proper hardness, we are going to take consideration of only 3: binder, disintegrant, and lubricant. All right. Now see what happens. He starts with the first trial, selects some amount of binder, some amount of disintegrant, and some amount of lubricant. And this choice of quantities he has made because in his mind, he has given some importance to the binder, to the disintegrant, to the lubricant. That is, in his mind, he has got some rough idea about the coefficients or the contributory powers of binder, disintegrant, and lubricant towards the hardness. And using these theta values, he has chosen these quantities, and now what he does is, mentally he does these calculations. those who have studied pharmaceutical statistics, they will know that this is a very popular, equation. Okay, it is a multiple regression, linear regression equation, or mimics that equation. So this experiment is performed, and based on that, he has got some predicted value of hardness in mind. When the experiment is performed, though, he results with, ends up with a very different value of hardness. Maybe the tablet is powdery, which means the hardness is less. What has gone wrong? What has gone wrong is he has ended up adding less amount of binder. And why did he end up adding less amount of binder? Of course, not intentionally. That is because he had overestimated this coefficient, overestimated this weightage given to this binder. He said that it is going to contribute a lot. Little bit dal diya to bhi bahut ho jayega. That did not happen. So, this is the error which he calculates. And now he goes back to performing the second experiment, training example 2. But here, what is the change which he makes? He makes adjustments in his understanding of the weightages, of the parameters, of the theta values. And at this point of time, he reduces the theta 1 mentally. He does not advertise that I am doing this. Mentally, he does that subconsciously. But because of that subconscious understanding, he automatically ends up increasing the binder. Maybe earlier he had underestimated or made a improper estimation of the theta 2 and theta 3 also. That also adjustments he makes in the mind and accordingly adjusts the disintegrant and lubricant quantities and ends up with these new values or new quantities of binder, disintegrant, lubricant, performs the experiment or predicts a second time. Generally, this prediction is going to be as earlier because he wants a hardness which is between 6 and 8. Gets a second response. This response naturally is going to be very close to the predicted response as compared to earlier. So the error will reduce. And even though error has reduced, he does not stop there. He wants to go very close to that ideal predicted response and goes on performing this trial after trial after trial, and we call that as trial and error, incidentally. And at some point of time, I can't see this. Yeah, the responses will be very close. The predicted and actual responses will be close, and that is where we'll say that he has learned to make proper hardness tablets. What we have understood till now, you can just read through this. I will just read the last line. Human learning is automatically improving the assumptions of theta values. The weightages, the coefficients are very important, and that is happening in our mind. Altering magnitudes of these, because the assumptions of theta change, the magnitudes of features, input variables automatically change in our mind. And when we perform further and further experiments, the actual response comes closer and closer to the predicted response. Now, please pay attention. What I have said over here, the last statement was the actual response is brought closer and closer to the predicted. All right. And make a highlight of that in your mind. We'll see what happens in machine learning later on. Okay. Now, we have seen human learning, and we have seen that it is such a beautiful thing. And ultimately, after some experience, some trials, you are going to ultimately learn to do something right. Now, if that is the case, why go for machine learning at all? Human learning is most supreme of all. It is nature's miracle, but still it has got some shortcomings. We will see what are those shortcomings. Humans can take inputs from limited features. We saw that milk, tea powder, water, sugar were the input variables in tea making learning. In the case of tablets, there were several, 7-8 features were there, but we decided to work on only 3, or that learner decided to work on only 3. That is because human mind cannot actually tolerate too many feature inputs at a time. Just imagine you are trying to alter the parameters or weightages in your mind for three variables, and all of a sudden the number of features become 100. What will happen is you'll get confused. You'll not be able to make those automatic adjustments. That miracle will not happen so smoothly. Also, human learning is one training example at a time you can process. Okay? It is sequential. You can take one learning example at a time, process the parameters, change the variables for the second experiment, undertake that second trial one at a time. And that is why human learning becomes time consuming. In the workplace, that is why we give importance to experience. Year after year after year, a person works on a tableting machine, he starts getting an understanding of. But you imagine that same person, can you inflict upon him 1,000 training examples at a time? It is impossible. You'll not be able to do that. The person will not be able to process the information. That is one of the shortcomings of human learning. It is personalized, non-transferable. I have learned, let us say, to do something right after 1,000, 2,000 trials. And I want my friend to learn that. Can I do something that Amir Khan had done in PK? That is, he holds the hand of another person and automatically the entire information gets that. That is not going to happen. It is non-transferable. It is personalized. So a person working in R&D for 15, 20, 25 years, all of a sudden when he retires, that void is filled. Because a new person is going to step in and he is going to require that much training. And that is why experience is of such large importance in the industry. So it is personalized and non-transferable. Predictions that you do, human predictions are very rarely quantitative. So a person is trying to make tablets of hardness 6. He will try to come close to 6. He will not be able to give quantitative, okay, in the fifth trial, I'm going to get exactly a hardness value of 6.2. That is not going to happen. But sometimes in pharmaceutical experimentation, that is what we want. We want an exact quantitative gauge of prediction of what is going to happen next. And this is precisely the reason why QBD, design of experiments, factorial designs and statistics became so very important in pharmaceutical industry. It is because regulatory bodies do not accept predictions made by human beings. Okay, you cannot say that, why did you change the disintegrant quantity to this much? That is because of human learning. I felt that it is going to, that is not going to be acceptable. So you have to have some evidence why it was changed, how it was changed. Now see, after decades of pharmaceutical industry and pharmaceutical research happening, you will understand that there is millions of gigabytes of data already available. And that data is wasted unless and until we use it for some purpose. If we use it for machine learning to make our predictions better and better, and naturally using this thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of data points, naturally we have seen that in 5-10 trials, things improve. So if you use so many values of trials, what is going to be the prediction? It is going to be wonderful. And that is why we should actually look at implementing machine learning in a large way in pharmaceutical research. This is just a theoretical definition of machine learning. It is a study of computer algorithms that improve automatically through experience. And machine learning basically is of two types. Today, what I was discussing so far as the human learning is concerned was the supervised learning, and that too, I had used the supervised learning to take the examples of regression. Today I did not cover anything about, although the child example was classification, But after that, I did not cover anything about classification, or I did not talk about unsupervised learning as far as humans are concerned. But there also, this is happening. So this is about the definition of machine learning. Now, we are in a position to actually embark on how machine learning occurs. Before I actually dwell into machine learning, let us just summarize what is learning. Learning is basically automatic adjustments of theta values. And what are theta values? These are the coefficients. These are the weightages that you are supposed to give to the input features. All right. Again, repeat. What is learning? Learning is automatic improvement or adjustments in the theta values. When that happens, learning takes place. And now we are going to see how machines can be made to do this wonderful task, which was happening inside the human mind. Automatic adjustments of theta values. How can machines do it automatically and going in the direction of improvement? Improvement means the predicted and actual response should be very close to each other. And that is what makes this particular subject so very thrilling, so very interesting. Now, as I said, in the case of machine learning, it is overcoming some disadvantage of human learning. And what was that disadvantage? It can process one learning example at a time, human brain. But that is not happening. This is not sequential. Machine learning, you can have M number of examples or trials. Here, for simplicity's sake, I have just shown 5. But can you imagine the number of data? You can have thousands, 10,000s, 1 lakh, 1 million training examples fed into the computer. Can human brains do that? No. The other thing is, although I have taken only 3 features, can you see? Binder, disintegrant, lubricant. But there can be 100, 200, 1000, 10,000 such features that you can feed to the computer. So just imagine the amount of data which a computer can handle for learning. Thousands of features, that is N features going horizontally, thousands and thousands and many, many, many more M number of learning examples. That is how, what you can achieve or use to train. And for each of these, here I have taken 5 examples. For each of those trials, there will be one output, Y1. So how many outputs will be there? Because there are 5 trials, there are 5 actual responses. Okay, actual responses. And that has been fed to the computer. Now, what does the algorithm do? What does the computer do? It uses some, what the humans were doing. It uses some initial theta 1. Only thing is, humans were choosing the x1, x2, x3 on the basis of this theta. That is not happening now. Already the x1, x2, x3, all the values are there in the computer. All the responses are also there in the computer. Now what the computer does is, it just takes the coefficients. Theta 1 assumes the coefficient. How many coefficients are there? Will be there? Naturally, since there are 3 features, there will be 3 coefficients. And using these assumed coefficients, it can be of any value, 0, 1, 1.5, 2, any value absolutely. It takes that. The algorithm does that. Using this, it makes the calculation of H1. Now you recollect, what was H value? It was a predicted response. Now, since there are 5 experiments performed, how many predictions will be there? There will be 5 predictions, H1, H2, H3, H4, H5. Now, once you have got 5 predictions, and how did the computer calculate these predictions? Very simple calculation. Theta 1 x1 plus theta 2 x2 plus theta 3 x3 will give me h1. Theta 1 x1 for the second example, theta 2 x2 for the second example, theta 3 x3 for the second example will give me H2. That is a prediction for the second example. Like this, you will get 5 predictions. And already you have got 5 actual responses. So what will the computer calculate next? Try to guess it. Yes, it will try to calculate the cost, the error. What is the difference between the predicted responses and the actual responses? And since naturally, this is the first time the computer has assumed some theta values, these answers are going to be miserably different. The predictions are going to be miserably different from the actual answers. So what will it do then? What was the human being doing? It was adjusting the thetas. The computer will be programmed. The algorithm, what it does is it automatically forces the computer to alter the values of theta. It alters the value of theta and recalculates the predictions. Again, the errors are calculated. Again, the thetas are calculated, and this goes on happening. Now see the differences between human learning. Here, it is not sequential. All the training examples are fed simultaneously along with the responses. Here, all the predictions for all the training examples is made simultaneously. And now a very big difference. Earlier, you were trying to bring the actual responses close to the predictions. Here, since you cannot do anything, the computer cannot do anything about the actual, they have already happened. That is why what the computer tries to do is, it tries to bring the predictions close to the actual responses. Okay, this is a big difference between what happens in human learning and in machine learning. But ultimately, all said and done, automatically the theta values will be such that the predictions will be very close to the, and the cost will be nearly zero. That is, the errors will be nearly zero. And then you can perform a test. Already the optimal theta values you have got automatically. The machine has got. Now the sixth example is fed, which is called as a test example. And then using the optimized theta values, the machine does the multiplication which it was doing earlier and estimates the H6, that is the prediction for the test sample or test example, and compares it with the Y6, that is the actual response for that particular test example. And if it is 90% close, 95% close, 85%, you will say that the learning is 85% accurate. 90% accurate, 95% accurate. Okay, this happens automatically. The algorithm causes. Now, all that we have to do now is just see, this is the learning process. All that we have to do now is understand what it does, we have just seen. How does the computer do it? That is what we have to understand. That is the last part of this machine learning. This is that data set which was input. X1, X2, X3 values for 5 trials and Y1, Y2, that actual responses for the 5 trials, they are given to the computer. The computer takes it in the form of matrices and vectors. So you will have to just give an Excel file or a CSV file. The algorithm ensures, or the computer program ensures, that it is taken in the form of matrix. See, these are the number of rows is equal to the number of trials, 5, and the number of columns is equal to the number of features. And this is the X matrix. Mark this as a very important matrix. Now, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to just add one more column intentionally to the X matrix. The first column which is added, it is the X0 column for all the, this should be 5. All the 5 training examples, X0 is added. And X0 is not something which is arbitrary. Always X0 is going to have the value. See, I have already written down the value. 1. It is always going to be 1. So all of a sudden, the computer, what it does is, it adds one more X set of X values to the matrix which it had prepared, the original matrix. the dimension of this matrix, this is all just maths. It is 5 into 4 because there are 5 rows over here and 4 columns. Earlier, it was a 5 by 3 matrix. That is 5 rows were there and only 3 columns for the 3 features. Now I have intentionally added one more feature, but that feature is a constant. Actually, it is a value 1. Next, you have got another matrix, or rather this is a single column matrix, which is actually a column vector. And in that there are the 5 values of the output. Let me remind you, this particular matrix as well as this Y vector can have any number of elements. Okay. This rows will be decided by the number of training examples. It could be 1,000, it could be 10,000. And the number of columns will be decided by the features. It could be 10 features, 15 features, 100 features, no matter what, the computer will be comfortable with all this data. So just make a note of this X matrix and Y matrix. Next, what the computer does is it initializes the theta vector. Now, if there are 3 features, naturally, how many coefficients should be there? 3. But here I had added intentionally one more feature. That was the 4th feature, x0. So naturally, the theta vector will also have 4 elements. It is a column vector. Each element of this vector is a coefficient for one particular feature. So this theta 0 is a coefficient for or weight for x0 feature. This is theta 1, which is a weight for x1, theta 2 for x2, and theta 3 for x3. So if there are 150 features, there will be 150 elements in this column vector. Now you initialize it. As I have told you, you ask the computer to assume absolutely any value. You can feed it. You will say, this is a vector of all ones. All ones means the computer will automatically take all these 4 values as ones. If you ask the computer, you initiate it with 0 values, then it will be 0. That you can decide. And this is the only time you will be making any contribution to the theta values. Hereafter, the algorithm will take care of it. Next, what will the computer do? What was happening? See the sequence of this thing. Input is taken, theta values are initialized, and now you calculate the predicted responses. These are the predicted responses. H1, H2, 5 experiments were there. So 5 predictions will be there. And this is the mathematical form. Let us see the vector form, because the computer is doing all the calculations in the form of vectors. What it does is very simple calculation. It multiplies the vector X with vector theta. Those who are familiar with matrix X with vector theta. Those who are familiar with matrix multiplications will see this. This is the X matrix. And this is the theta vector. You know that in vector multiplication or matrix multiplications, what is the product dimensions? The rows in the product are equal to the rows in the first matrix, this one, X matrix. So here, how many rows are there? 5. So in the product matrix, 5 rows will be there. Okay. And the number of columns in this product, final matrix, which is obtained, it is equal to the number of columns in the second matrix, that is in this theta. So how many columns are there? 1. So ultimately in the product, there will be 5 rows, but 1 column, and each element corresponds to this calculation. See, theta plus theta 1 x1 plus theta 2 x2 plus theta 3 x3. The second element will be theta 0 into x, 1 plus theta 1 into this x1 value, the second experiment value, so on and so forth. And ultimately, you will get the predictions. Next, what is done? Try to remember the sequence. You have got the predictions. You have got the actual responses. What will you do? You will calculate the difference. It is the error. error naturally is predicted minus actual for all the five training examples. And in the vector form, this will be very simple calculation, h vector minus y vector. And we have seen what is h vector, we have seen what is y vector. And you get end up getting this error. And all this we are doing to find out the cost. Okay. Next, what is done is the square of the errors is found out. That is, first you have, you should ask yourself the question why. If the answer is obvious to you, it is good, or you can include it in the questions later on. I will move ahead. So square is taken of the error. The computer does this very simply. It does element wise multiplication. And after you have got the squares of the errors, what you will do is the term which is popular in statistics, sum of squares. This is the sum of squares. Okay. Although I have shown this in two steps, the sum of squares can be obtained directly also. Can you guess how? If you simply take transpose of this E vector, multiply it with E vector. So transpose of E multiplied by E will directly give you the summation, sum of squares. You need not have this step, but I have actually showed it stepwise. Now, once the sum of squares is calculated, what will be done? Half mean square. So mean square, this is again a term which is popular in statistics, mean square. What is mean square? Sum of the squares divided by the number of training examples. Number of training examples. How many squares were there? Five squares were there. Because how many errors were there? Five errors were there. Why five errors were there? Because five predicted responses and five actual responses were taken into consideration for these calculations. So the mean squared error is found out for calculation purpose. Again, you can keep this as a query or you can figure it out on your own. Half of the mean square is taken. So you divide it by two again. And this actually is the cost function. This is a very important concept. This is the cost function. It is the measure of how much the predicted responses have deviated from the true responses. As J becomes more, the deviation is naturally more. As J reduces, the deviations reduce. Naturally, what will be the aim of the algorithm? To increase the J or to decrease the J? Naturally, it will be to decrease the cost, decrease the J, decrease the errors. This is the vectorized implementation of how the J is calculated. It is more important for you to understand what is J. J is the half mean square of the errors. Are the theta values and J related? Now it all started with the assumption of the theta values. You had assumed some theta values. Maybe it was zero or it was one. And that was naturally not the correct theta values. It was the first assumption made by the computer. So naturally the errors are going to be more. The J value is going to be more. So is J related to theta? Yes. J is because of the cost is because of the theta. More wrong the theta, greater will be the J, right? So it is a big yes. If assumed theta values are very different from the true theta values, predicted responses will be very different from actual responses, and the cost function J will be high. If you mentally try to visualize, now this graph actually will not exist, but if you try to mentally visualize the relationship between J on the y-axis against theta on the x-axis, the graph will look something like this. If the theta, assume theta is very different from the true theta, you will see that the J values, the errors are very high. And as your assumed thetas go towards the true thetas, what will happen? It will become optimal. The J values will reduce. This should happen. The machine should do this, and it should do this automatically. Now we are going to see how does the machine do this automatically? And that will be the last part of machine learning, the most important part of gradient descent. This is an animation. It is showing that if you are on a slope and if you want to go down, what are you going to make use of? You're naturally going to make use of the slope. So go down the slope, use the slope. And that is why this algorithm is called as gradient. Gradient means slope. Descent means going down. So going down the slope is what the gradient descent algorithm does. The J values go down the slope till they reach the very minimum. And that is achieved by changing the theta values. Okay. See how it is done. Let us consider on the left hand side. Can you see the cursor? Here, what is the slope? Those who are familiar with geometry and this thing, you will realize that this slope is negative. This is negative slope. And where is the slope positive? This is positive slope. So what I will do is now just see the assumption. I will calculate the slope and ask the computer, or what the computer will do on its own is, from the theta, it will subtract the slope. All right. So now what happens is, from the theta, if the slope is subtracted, let us see what will happen over here. Here the slope is negative. From the theta, you are subtracting a negative slope. So what will happen? It will be theta plus the slope. See, theta minus a negative slope. It will be theta plus the slope. So naturally, in the further experimentation, theta values will increase. And you don't, this is not rocket science. It will, by default, that will happen. Now look at the right hand side. If the thetas are wrong on this side, that is the J is high on this side, what type of a slope is this? It is a positive slope. So when you have fed to the algorithm that you are supposed to subtract the slope from the theta, what will happen? Theta minus a positive slope, minus a positive value, will end up reducing the theta value. So see, here the theta value will reduce. So a single calculation, that is new theta will be minus, sorry, old theta minus the slope. It ensures that even if the theta is less, you will end up getting a greater and greater value of theta. And if the theta is higher than what should have been the true value, you will automatically, the theta will go down. This is what is going to take place really. What do you think will happen at the minimum? What is the slope over here? You'll see the line is nearly horizontal. What does a horizontal line mean? Slope is zero. So as soon as the theta values reach over here, the J value reaches over here, the slope becomes zero. And what is the update? It is theta minus the slope, but the slope at convergence, at minimum, the slope is zero. So theta minus zero, minus zero. So theta will stay at convergence. Automatically, the algorithm will stop updating the theta values. And that is the beauty of it. Automatically, the theta values will get updated depending on the slope. And when the theta values are correct, further updation will stop. And that is what happens with humans also. Once I have learned to drive, I don't actually go on learning. I drive by reflex. That is something which will happen over here. This is a visualization of the gradient descent. Now, some of you will definitely should argue that all this is imaginary. So if this graph is imaginary, the slope is also imaginary. So how will you get the slope? So you need not get the slope. What happens is, at any given point, slope is calculated as y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. If this difference gap, I reduce it and I try to find out what is the slope over here at one point, it will not be y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. It will be a derivative term, dy by dx. So it will, at a single point, it is going to be not a finite slope being calculated. It will be the derivative term. So dj, what is there on the y-axis? J. So dj, dy. So dj by dx. What is there on the x-axis? The theta value. So dj by d theta, that derivative term becomes important. And for that, the imaginary graph is also okay. So that is what is shown over here. Dj, partial derivative, of course, partial differential of j with respect to the theta value. Since the j value is 1 upon 2m summation of this, those who remember derivatives or partial derivatives, you will know that if I take a derivative, it will end up giving me this answer. Okay. How many such derivative terms will be there? Equal to the number of thetas, because there are, how many theta values are there? Four features are there, theta 0, theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3. So you will get four values of derivatives. And what is the update? The new theta will be equal to old theta minus the derivative term. So what I do now is I take a vector, a column matrix, single column matrix, which is a column vector of the derivative terms. And I will not go into the maths of this. This is how it is calculated. Again, it is a simple matrix multiplication. And since the computer is doing it, it can handle n number of columns and m number of rows. See, this is the update. The new theta automatically is equal to old theta minus, now this is an interesting term, learning rate into the derivative term. So it is actually theta minus the derivative term only, but some function of the derivative term, that is learning rate multiplied. The learning rate is used because you'll see that sometimes the slope is very gradual. So it will take a long time. Sometimes it is very steep. So you will end up jumping over here. So you want to have a learning rate which will ensure that this goes down in a very systematic way and does not take too long to converge, or does not, you know, overshoot the convergence also. Okay. Once the update rule is applied, so see, new theta values you will get, new theta values. As soon as you get new theta values, again, the predictions will be done. Predictions are done compared with the true y values. Error vector will be found out. Error square vector will be found out. J value will be calculated. And again, the derivative term will be calculated. And this will go on happening. Iterations. These are called as iterations. You can say that I want 1,000 iterations, 10,000 iterations. The computer will do all these iterations automatically in a few minutes. And naturally, at convergence, what will happen? This delta J value will be zero. So this entire will be zero. So new thetas will be naturally equal to the old thetas. It will stabilize over there. This is, now you see, what is to be done, I have told you. Okay, why it is to be done, I have told you. How the computer thinks or operates also. But how will you tell the computer to do that? For that, computer programming languages are available. Python, Octave, okay, R, many such programming languages are there. And this is a code written, my brother helped me with this. This is a code written in Python. Okay. Python is a very popular programming language for machine learning. And if you see the details over here, later on when this video is on YouTube, you can just refer to this particular thing. Now the pharmacists or pharmacy teachers will say that this is very difficult for us. This is not difficult actually. If you know what is to be done, it is simple. For example, if you want to know how do you say good day in French, you need not know the language. You can simply, because you know what to ask, you can Google how to say good day in French and you will get bonjour, immediately the internet will tell you. Like this, if you know what is to be told or what is to be asked, you can ask internet. There is a community, GitHub. You can ask over there how to actually import X and Y in the form of vectors and matrices. You will get the code for that. How to initialize the theta values with one, value one. You'll get a code for it. How to calculate the predictions using these vectors and matrices. You will get it. How to calculate the J value. Already the codes are available. The language is already being written. It is on the net. You have to simply know what to ask and you will be able to compile something like this. And once this is compiled, you can actually train the computer, make it learn. 10,000 learning examples you can use, or training examples you can use. Thousands of features can be included. Now, last part of the discussion, potential for applying machine learning in QBD. My research interest is not QBD, but from whatever I have heard about QBD, pure QBD is, you have to have an identification of critical parameters. Now, this is something in QBD also, it is done by human learning, human experience. You have to say that I don't think that this is. Now, when machine learning is there to handle millions of data points to tell you which thetas are more and which thetas. See, what is theta? It is a weightage. It is the importance. So if you train the computer, you cause bring about machine learning using 10,000 learning examples, the data for which is already available, you will be able to get the theta values for all the features which are likely for, let us say, extruder spheronizer or for tablet coating. And those features for which theta is very close to zero or very negligible, you can say they are non-critical, eliminate that. But you will have used some good logic, machine learning for arriving at it. Gut feelings are, of course, going to be there. You cannot overrule human learning, but some help you can get from machine. The other point is identification of design space. You know that design of experiments is needed for this. And what is design space? Simply arriving at, now those who are interested in statistics, those who had attended biostats yesterday will remember a very important multiple linear regression equation, which is y is equal to beta zero. Over there, it is called beta zero plus beta one x1, beta two x2, beta three x3, so on and so forth. And then the interaction terms. All right. And that calculation is done using statistical software. Many statistical software are there, SAS and all that. Alternately, you can use machine learning to arrive at those same beta values. Beta zero value will be theta zero in machine learning. Beta one will be theta one in beta one, two, that is the interaction term, will be theta one, two in machine learning. And finally, most importantly, monitoring of actual production is done using process analytical technology. Just imagine you are working in a pharmaceutical industry for 10 years and you have got batch manufacturing records for all the batches that have been manufactured. So you have got how many learning examples? Thousands of them. And you have got many features over there. What was the batch size? What quality of raw material was used? For how much time the batch was shaken? How much time drying was performed? And finally, you have got also the output values. What was the hardness of the tablets made for batch number one 10 years ago? And like that, 10,000 such responses, actual responses you have got. If you simply feed those in the gradient descent, using the gradient descent algorithm to machine learning, what you will be able to get is the accurate theta values, very accurate theta values for all these features, all the variables which were there in the batch manufacturing. And when that happens, today, let us say you are manufacturing a new batch. All that you have to do is to predict what is going to be the quality to keep the production under control is you have to feed those X1, X2, X3 values theta 1, theta 2, theta 3 values have already been calculated using machine learning, you will be able to get an very good prediction of what is going to be the output of today's batch. And this is a prediction. So if the prediction is not right, at least you will be able to take corrective measures earlier. Isn't this quality by design? It can be, it is. With this, I have concluded my talk. I wish to give acknowledgements, first of all, to my brother, Milind Gide. He is image processing, machine learning algorithm designer at Apple. He is the one who got me interested in machine learning. And I owe him a lot in terms of solving my difficulties in this intricate subject. I would also like to thank Andrew Ng, acknowledge him, because it was on Milind's suggestion I had joined his, in fact, he had registered me in this course on machine learning on Coursera. And I was able to polish a lot of my concepts because of these two gentlemen. Thank you. I am open for questions. Please stick to questions on machine learning or the topic that I have taught. Vague questions, try to avoid.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an informative session. All the participants are very much happy that you have explained in such a lucid manner and with such simple explanations and examples. There are a few questions. One question is, how to know the QBD components?
QBD components. I'm not able to exactly get the query. QBD components basically are critical parameter. You have to control the critical parameters and critical processes. The second component is design space identification, that is design of experiments where you use factorial design or any such good design to ensure that the experiments are done in a nested fashion, so that one level of one particular feature gets, or input variable gets tested with all the levels of other features, so that there is no one factor at a time approach taken. And final component of QBD, as I mentioned, it is process analytical technology. See, what is being done in QBD basically is, you first of all find out what is critical for the quality. You control those aspects properly. Then you arrive at the design space, that is how much of each component you should select so that you will get the expected response or expected quality from the product. And finally, during manufacturing, you will ensure that the process is under statistical control. For example, in PAT, what is done is, if you are doing tablet coating, you use IR sensors for that during the coating process, so that after 10 minutes, 15 minutes, if you get a particular IR response for a particular functional group and it reaches that threshold value, you will say that, okay, the coating is good enough. A similar approach is used for the drying process of granules. You monitor the water absorption peak using process analytical technology. When that water peak reaches a particular threshold value, which you have previously decided. And that is where I am telling that using machine learning, you can arrive at all these values which you want to control. I hope I have addressed the question.
Yeah, thank you, sir. The next question is, you can suggest any softwares for this machine learning?
Python, Octave, R. Python is the best. That is okay. What those who are working in machine learning have told me. Milind also tells me the same thing.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much for this informative session. Now we'd like to hand over the session to Ms. Heta.
Thank you so much, Gide sir, for your valuable information that you shared with us today. It was really a very good session. Moving forward to our next speaker, the next part of the session. Our next speaker for the day is Dr. Rajendra Dhande. Sir is working as a teacher in pharmacology department of Konkan Gyanpith Rahul Darkar College of Pharmacy and Research Institute with approximately 7 years of experience. Sir has worked with renowned companies like TCS as a disclosure coordinator and Anazil Analyticals and Research Private Limited as in charge of clinical operations. Sir is well versed with authoring regulatory documents including protocols, ICF, CRF, CSR, ICHGCP and study formats and standard operating procedures as per various regulatory guidelines and bioanalytical methodologies. Sir has a deep knowledge of concepts of drug metabolism and biopharmaceutics with an expertise in designing and conducting of bioavailability and bioequivalence studies for solid, liquid and inhalation, etc. dosage forms. Sir has completed B.Pharm from Bombay College of Pharmacy in 2004, M.Pharm in pharmacological specialization from Bharti Vidyapeeth College of Pharmacy in 2007 with first class. He has secured 91.14 percentile in GATE 2004, conducted by Indian Institute of Technology Kanpur. Sir has badged with third prize in podium and poster presentation at Avishkar, an inter-university research competition Mumbai held in January 2011, and also received an AICTE fellowship for the year 2004 to 2006. Sir has delivered over 8 guest lectures for various topics such as prospective of clinical research, role of regulatory authorities in clinical research, drug discovery and preclinical research, clinical trial development and management and medical writing, etc. So he has presented over 9 posters and attended over 5 workshops and symposiums and was a part of organizing team for 3 workshops and symposiums and conferences held at national levels. Sir also holds a lifetime membership of Indian Pharmacological Society. Sir, we welcome you to this session and I hand over the session to you.
Thank you, Heta. Thanks a lot. Hear my such a beautiful introduction first time. Okay. I think I'm audible.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay, that's great. Okay, so starting with the session today, we are going to discuss about the disclosures in clinical trials and the ethics involved in the disclosure, the practice of disclosures during the clinical trial. I hope my screen is visible to everybody.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. So starting with the agenda, that what we are going to, I will introduce you guys with what is disclosure, the need of disclosure in clinical research, the various types of disclosures involved in the clinical research, the evolution of disclosure, mandate of disclosure, then regulatory bodies and regulations involved in disclosure, elements of disclosures in registry, then redacted regulatory documents, plain language summary, and advantages and disadvantages of disclosure. So moving further, what is disclosure? If we discuss about this, then it is something like the act of making something known or the fact that is made known. Okay, means if suppose whatever the findings coming up through the research, then the disclosure is something like you are putting it into the public domain as a open access to everybody, and whoever wants to access that particular information should be able to access without any type of charges or without any type of restrictions. Okay, so that is what is disclosure. Now, you must be knowing that since the clinical trials are taking up, lots of clinical trials are going throughout the globe, and it's a very, very important phase of the drug development. So and it is directly dealing with the human the human participants are involved in the research. And many a times it is happening that it is humans are getting dosed with the first time with that new chemical entity. So always there is the matter of transparency, the involvement of the data, the roles of the government, the restrictions, the regulations, the human human rights, and the safety of the volunteers. These all these type of issues are coming up nowadays, and those have been discussed with a very loud voices. So definitely the transparency during the clinical trial is the utmost priority when and it is indicated by each and every regulatory and each and every organization involved in the clinical research. So what is the need of disclosure in clinical trial? If we if we discuss about this, okay, many a times it is observed that whatever the results are coming up from the clinical trial, those are not transparently put or disseminated into the public domain. And it is even there are many of the systematically cross-sectional studies have been conducted showing that whatever the data is found in the clinical trial, it is not exactly published in the journals related to the clinical trial. The most of the articles which are published for the clinical trials, they are obviously they are putting only the positive results. They are posing more and more importance towards the positive results, the study completions, the compliance, the how the study was compliant, and there were very few adverse events and all. Okay, but if we see the other part of thing, which is not that transparent, is the negative results, the SAEs, serious adverse events, which took place during the clinical trials, the dates, subjects' safety issues, the reasoning of subjects' withdrawal and non-compliances. Okay, so this particular thing is always kept in the opaque and the haze format, and it has not been disclosed in the public domain very effectively. Okay. There are many the negative, wherever there are negative results, the data dumping, or the delay in the publication, or if there are days no dates, no proper reasoning for the dates, or there are, if suppose there are withdrawals because of the safety issues or non-compliance of the from the sponsors, those are not actually published or reflected in the public domain. So this is, this has been observed, and the big cry was started in the last two decades that this should become in very, very transparent way. So that's why the initiatives were taken up to start some regulatory aspect or regulatory conditions in which the all these data will be reflected in the public domain very effectively and transparently. So the need of disclosure again is report induced by the reporting biases in the published literature, as I discussed, that the bias towards the positive and the negative results, the research are inconsistently or selectively reported. That also we have discussed, that inconsistently means those particular with the compliances or dates related matters were not highlighted properly. Most of the trials are not published only. Means there are many trials are happening, but each and every trial is not coming to the public domain in the form of published articles. Okay. And it is not mandatory to publish the article. So wherever the results are not good, the results are objectionable, the compliances are not there, the GCP compliances are not there, okay, at a time people sponsors tried to avoid publishing of the trial. Though it is published after a considerable time after the study completion, so let us say today the study is getting over and the publication is coming after 2 years. So by that time, the entire matter of the clinical trial is settled. The even everybody, the regulatory, the researchers, the involved participants, everything got you know faded. And then after this fading effect, the publication is performed. So the studies have also found that, and these are the published studies, means the peer reviewed journals have published this kind of studies, that studies have also found that the trial results reported to the regulatory agencies are differed from significantly from the results publicly reported in the journal. This for the regulatory authorities who are going to give the permissions and who are actually looking after the protocols and the result summaries, and they have the entire raw data as well as the subject level data for them, the results were reported something different from what are reported into the public domain, that is journals. Like for the regulatory authorities, probably the dates are 50 in the publication, the dates due to occurred in that entire study are reported only 30. So even these kind of scenarios are also observed, and after investigation, those particular the publications were also taken back. In year 2006, a sponsor conducted this is one of the very, very crucial parameters that why the disclosure is needed. And being a researcher, even though we are in the academic sector and we are not directly related to the corporate clinical trials, but definitely somewhere this kind of information is relatively very, very important to know about. That one of the incidents happened here, which I have reported here. That is, in 2006, a sponsor conducted a phase 1 trial in healthy volunteers that caused catastrophic systemic organ failure, resulted in all 6 trial subjects. Okay, a controversy was come up and discussed when it was coming to know that similar study had been done in 1994. In 1994 with the similar outcomes, and it was suggested that it had been avoided, or the trial information been available in the public registry, perhaps the second trial would never been conducted and patient safety would have been reported. Means if suppose this particular, the earlier study which was conducted in 1994, if suppose this the data of this particular study would have been available in the public domain, probably the researcher would have gone through that particular the study details, and this kind of disaster would have been avoided. So the disclosures avails the reference to the researcher. Even another point where it is very, very important that in most of the time in the Western world, people due to the very heavy health cost, people used to keep on searching for the clinical trials for their own specific indications from which they are suffering into. Okay, so the patients is to keep on searching for the clinical trial. If so, let us say somebody is suffering from the heart disease and coronary blockade, and there is some certain study recruitment is going on in which the similar kind of subjects are required, and those will be treated by the new upcoming therapy, okay, which is a targeted therapy for that clinical trial. Okay, so if this particular type of information is available, the subjects used to, or the participants used to contact to that particular recruitment sites or the sponsors, and they get enrolled if they are matching with the inclusion and exclusion criteria, and they get the proper treatment, or they get subjected towards the new treatment which is targeted during the clinical trial. So it is one of the information portal for the patients as well. then information readily available in public domain. If the disclosures are available in public domain, then the information will be easily available in public domain. Information related to the patient safety from previous experiences can be observed and studied. And a similar kind of, if suppose similar kind of studies are to be planned, then this particular data can be used to avoid the further or take the further precautions to avoid the similar kind of results. Okay, can avoid repeating the similar mistakes to ensure the patient safety. What are the types of disclosures involved in clinical trials? They are the protocol summary, result summary, plain language summaries. The plain language summary is nowadays it is one of the most focused disclosure type. I'll be explaining this in the further part. Then redacted regulatory documents, financial disclosures, manuscripts, publications in scientific journals. So the protocol summary and the result summary. The protocol summary is something like it provides you all the details in the form of summary, okay, in which just prior to the initiation of the study. So this particular part, the protocol summary, needs to be disclosed before the initiation of the study, means even the first the enrollment of the first subject. Okay, this particular protocol summary needs to be disclosed on registry of the specific regulatory body in under which the particular study is planned. Okay, the result summary is something. Result summary is after this used to be after getting certain results from the study, and generally the study is is split into the primary outcomes, the secondary outcomes. So the result summaries needs to be published for these particular outcomes, and you have to declare that what has happened during that study. Okay, plain language summary, it is specially designed for the people who are not actually involved in the this particular field. Though somebody is a PhD in quantum physics, but that person do not understand what is arthritis, okay, or the details of the anatomy and physiology, and do not understand anything or the related part of the clinical trial. Okay, so for that particular person, that particular person for clinical trial is a lay person. Okay, so the summaries which are dealing with the entire information without any type of technical jargons and without the general day-to-day rules and regulations, whatever we are following in the clinical research, we need to prepare a plain language summary which can be understood by even the sixth, a person who is learning in the sixth, or a student who is learning in the sixth standard. Okay, redacted redacted regulatory documents, they are involved. The redacted regulatory documents are something like a protocol, the entire protocol of a clinical trial, the entire result or the clinical study report of a clinical trial in the redacted form. The redacted form means the personal identification information and many of the crucial data related to specific person, okay, are removed. Okay, they are masked by using the redaction tool. Then financial disclosures. Financial disclosure is one of a very, very important part of clinical trial, and it's not the recent matter, but it is since long back. Actually, the financial disclosures which are asked by the regulatory bodies between the investigators and the sponsor, means the investigator, whoever is the investigator or the principal investigator at the investigating site, okay, that person should not be influenced by the sponsor in terms of financial aspects. Okay, so if suppose the person is related or influenced by the financial agreements, then definitely there can be a chance of some kind of betterment is offered towards the intervention that can happen. So that's why these financial disclosures are important. Manuscripts and publication in scientific journal, these are very, we everybody know that manuscripts, whatever the outcomes are there in out in the research, are getting published as a manuscript. Okay. Medias to disclose whatever I have discussed before. So medias to disclose all these type of disclosures are the clinical trial registry of specific regulatory body, regulatory authority. Like example, for India, it is CTRI, that is Clinical Trial Registry of India. Then CTG, clinicaltrial.gov, UtraCity. This is for the European regulatory body. Okay. Then these are the clinical, these are the regulatory authority specific registries. However, nowadays, to maintain the transparency of the data, even the companies are also taking care, and they are also putting up their own studies in a public domain through their own clinical trial registers, and presenting their own clinical outcomes and in this particular on their particular clinical trial registers. Okay, the scientific journals, example, the Journal of Clinical Trials is also one of the media for disclosure. Official database portals, example, U portal for plain language summary is also a media for disclosing the disclosures. Now we will go quickly go through the evolution of disclosure, that how the disclosure evolved and progressed and reached to the today's scenario. Okay, the Declaration of Helsinki present the first major initiative in the timeline for transparency, and as per the we everybody know that without the Declaration of Helsinki we cannot proceed for the clinical trial. There are the 13 points which needs to be enacted during the clinical trials, which are strictly and should be complied totally during the clinical trial. And if suppose there is any type of violation in this the declarations, then it is considered to be the protocol violations or the non-compliance towards the GCP. Okay, the declaration was first adopted in 1964. After that, there were seven times the amendments are happened. The latest amendment was took place in Brazil, October 2013. And in this particular amendment, it is specifically mentioned that every research study involving human subjects must be registered in a publicly accessible database before recruitment of the first subject. So as per the, now it is included in the Declaration of Helsinki as well, that every study must have to be registered before the recruitment of first subject. If suppose it is not registered to the registry, the regulatory body's registry place, then it is not a compliance. In 2000, the clinicaltrial.gov was implemented as a result of Food and Drug Administration Modernization Act in 1997. So in 1997, this act was passed, and the US FDA, with collaboration with NIH, they collaboratively prepared formed a site, and it is taking care of registry maintenance and the registration of US studies at this particular website. in September, in case of in September 2016, United States States Department of Health and Human Services (HHS) amended Title 8 of Food and Drug Administration Amendment Act of 2007 as final rule. This FDAAA, this particular act was amended in 2007 for the preparation of the disclosures and the mandatory parts which are the fields which to be, you know, disclosed during this database were decided in 2007. That was again amended in 2016, and now it is implemented as a final rule. And till this particular final rule, actually the previously it was up to the sponsors or the companies which have conducted a clinical trial. It was voluntarily available that okay, if they want to share some particular data apart from the protocol and result summary, okay, they will be able to share. But now it is mandated, okay, and the trial that start on or after January 18, 2017, after this particular date, or with a primary completion date. If suppose the primary completion date means the primary outcomes are getting completed after this particular date, then definitely they have to follow the final rule and rule requirements and have to publish the study on this particular website, that is in the database, that is clinicaltrial.gov. As of January 2018, all provisions of final rule are in full effect. Means now, previously it was in the draft mode. Now it is after 2018, January 2018, it is in 100% operate. The final mode, and all the rules and regulations are now decided and explained. So this is just a pictorial or diagrammatic representation that how from 2000 how that the registry or the disclosure registration is mandated and reached till today. Okay, so in 2000 only 1255 studies were only reported, okay, when the clinical trials trial.gov was launched. And now the data is of 2019, almost 3 lakh record posted in clinical trial gov. Clinical trial registry of India, hosted at ICMR Institute, National Institute of Medical Statistics, that is nims-icmr.nic.in. It was launched in July 2007, and initially it was initiated as a voluntary measure for the Indian companies to follow the for the submission of the protocol or the result summaries. But since 2009, the trial registration in CTRI has been made mandatory by the Drugs Controller General India, DCGI. So if no trial is registered on this particular portal, CTRI, then you will not be able to get the permission or the approval to the protocol for further conduction of the clinical trial. So that particular measure India has taken up, near about all the studies whichever are conducted after 2009 are posted and registered on the CTRI. The European Union clinical trial register, that is clinical trials register.eu, was launched in 2011. However, the information contained in EU clinical trial registry is extracted from European Union Drug Regulating Authorities clinical trial, that is EudraCity, and it is only EudraCity, Okay, the EU clinical trial that it is the EU clinical trial database. Utracity is commenced in 2004. So though this particular portal is launched and existing from 2011, but the database was taken up from Utracity, which was actually recording the data since 2004. So earlier it was voluntarily, it was offered voluntarily to the pharmaceutical field that, okay, or whichever that clinical trials are getting planned, okay, it was voluntary on the voluntary norms, but later on the things become mandated for each and every trial. In 2005, the International Committee of Medical Journal, ICMJE, into this particular group of journals, and which includes the leading medical journals, instituted a policy, and its member journals would only publish trials that had been registered in public trial registry at or before the time of first patient enrollment. If this is the situation, if this particular norm is followed, then only these particular journals are going to publish the or accept the article for publication. FDA, US FDA mandated the act in 2007 under section 801, mandated the registration and result posting for all applicable clinical trials on a public database. Okay. And under the FDAAA, a non-phase one clinical trial must be registered if it has at least one site in United States or in investigating a drug device or biological agent that is subject to FDA oversight. So if there is any type of medicine or device or biological product which is going to get launched into US territories, or it is getting investigated in US territories, then definitely the protocol should be registered with FDAAA. Under the FDAAA rule with clinicaltrial.gov. As per FDAAA, result must be reported within 12 months of trial completion, and failure to comply can result in a penalty of up to 10,000 rupees per day, $10,000 per day. Okay, so you can imagine that how big this amount is just for one day. So the compliance is very, very important in this particular matter. When I used to work for the disclosure, we used to face that, okay, the date is after 2 months, but within next 5 or 6 days, we must have to complete the things because we don't want to go even a single day beyond the deadline. Okay, so whenever the clinical trial will end, the end of the clinical trial used to be the last subject, last visit of the participant. Okay, the last participant when is having the last visit, that used to be the end of the trial. Okay, EOT, it is called as EOT. So from that particular date, within 12 months of the duration, you must have to publish the results of that particular clinical trial, that what are the findings and what was the total statistics of the subjects. Everything needs to be, you know, published within 12 months. And if suppose the sponsor or the party is failing to do such, then definitely there was a huge penalty of $10,000 per day. One more thing I want to discuss with this particular penalty, that apart from this penalty only, the NIH used to put a remark in front of the protocol summary which was posted for that particular clinical trial, that the sponsor has failed to present the results. So this particular remark is very means for a pharmaceutical company is a matter of prestige, and definitely the confidence in their the NIH has taken measure that the penalties are there. Even the image will also get spoiled, and that's why the compliance will be held 100%. The clinical trial registries of across the globe, okay, and the various regulatory bodies involved in the in this particular disclosure system are United States, Canada, European Union, Australia, China, India, Japan, and these are their links of their registries. Okay, so all these countries have registry, and they used to register the clinical trials on this particular portals, the disclosure portals at their end. Now, WHO had recommended the elements of disclosure in registry. So WHO has decided that certain points or the elements must be considered and considered, and those will be those will be followed. Okay, and every each and every part of the this particular elements to be accomplished during the disclosure. Okay, so the elements are the primary registry or trial identifying number. So this particular number provides trial provides a very a unique number. So across the globe, everywhere, this particular the trial will be recognized. It will recognized across the globe, and though the similar type of studies are indicated in with the same indications or same investigation of product, there will not be mixing of two trials, and the results will be identified uniquely. Okay, the date of registration in primary registry, so the secondary identifying numbers, the source and monetary or material support, primary sponsor, all these are the elements which needs to be fulfilled. I'll be taking you guys to the actual disclosure site, and we'll be showing all these elements in one of the disclosure at NIH or clinicaltrial.gov site. So we'll go quickly through the different elements for this particular study, which is the pharmacokinetic, the safety, tolerability, and the clinical effect of topical umeclidinium in primary axillary hyperhidrosis. Okay, so in this particular study, so this is the view of the clinicaltrial.gov. It is a registration site, okay, in which the study details are provided, all those particular the segments or the different elements are there, those are been put. Okay, in this tabular view you can see the protocol. Okay, in this protocol it is mentioned that when the protocol was first time submitted and when it was actually posted to the clinical trial, this particular site, then what are the primary outcomes?
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, site is not visible. Site is not visible right now.
Site is not visible.
Leave
okay.
The PPT we can say, able to say.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so just give me a minute.
PPT is visible. Now we can see the PPT visible.
Okay.
Yes.
Now my screen is visible. Is the site is visible now?
Yes.
Okay. So this particular this is a registry site for US FDA. It is maintained by NIH for FDA, and the site name is clinicaltrial.gov. I think whoever has you know searched for some type of clinical trial protocol you know designing and all must have gone through this particular site. Okay, so in this particular part, the study details, this particular tab, it provides you the entire information about the trials in brief. Okay, and the overview of the trial, that what has happened, what was the protocol, and then how many subjects were involved, what is the intervention, what type of study it is interventional study, non-interventional study, how many, what was the condition of disease, means what was the indication, then what are the treatments or interventions which are used, and what was the phase. Okay, so whatever the details involved in the protocol are already been displayed on this particular part just before initiation of the study. Means if all these details are to be posted on this particular site for this study before the first recruitment of the subject. Okay, so and the difference between this particular record and the publication is that we are writing the manuscript and sending to the publishing journal. Okay, but it is not it gets peer reviewed, but that what we can say, the raw data or the background data is not checked. When we are putting the protocol and the results on this particular site, this is the result part. Okay, after completion of the study, the entire results are put on this particular site. In this part, what is the again the study type, what was, how many participants were recruited, when the recruitment started, and when the recruitment was ended. Okay, all these minute details are given in this. Each and every participant's fate during that particular study is written, that a total of 28 participants were randomized. However, 20 five got a screen failure, and the others, the 23 participants received umeclidinium. Out of that, 18 participants received umeclidinium, and 5 participants received placebo. So this minute information is also provided over here, and all this information is checked and cross-checked with the actual clinical trial study report, clinical study report, whatever is provided to the FDA, it is cross-checked against that. So there is no problem as such that you are publishing something else and actually it is happened something else. Okay, so it remains quite transparent. In this, there are the main fields are that what was the baseline characteristics, then how many participants were, the participant flow. In this participant flow, how many started, how many completed, how many not completed, what were the reasons of not completion, how many participants did a protocol violation, then how many subjects withdrew from the study. So the entire information is provided very systematically. Then the description of the arm or group by which the treatment was given. Okay, and then outcome measures, in which the which are the primary outcomes and what was the result, how many participants. Suppose this is the particular data, this is the outcome on day 12, then how many participants were contributing to that particular data, this and what was the percentage of that particular contributing participants is also provided. So it is more or less presenting certain results on the web in the public domain that anybody can refer this particular data very transparently and reliable data, because it is checked against the data which is the sponsor of the trial is providing to the regulatory bodies for approval or compliance of certain product. Okay, so that's why it remains quite transparent, and whatever is actually happened during the clinical trial is reflected. After outcomes, the whatever side effects occurred in this particular study are also given. So this is the outcome. In outcome, actually, the title of the outcome means that is what was your evaluation criteria and what was the title of the evaluation criteria. The description of the evaluation criteria, that what was evaluated and how it was evaluated, the time frame, that at what time you have evaluated this particular certain outcome, and these are the values, the outcomes, these are the values, and its related statistics is also provided, even with the comparison group and what was the confidence interval and what was the method of which was the statistical method and all. After that, the adverse events are presented, and the adverse event time frame is also given, that the generally in this particular portal, whenever a subject gets enrolled into the study, right from that particular day, even though that particular participant have administered or not the study specific drugs, even after that as well, you will have to reflect the adverse event. What are the causes of mortality, any serious adverse events and other side effects? Each and every side effect or the adverse event have to be provided with the MedDRA coding, in the MedDRA coding fashion. So you will be able to understand that what are the highly repetitive or frequent adverse events are there, and you can justify that, okay, this particular adverse event is happened once only in a one participant only. So from the particular percentage, that how many times it occurred, based upon that, the frequency or the relation to the drug, relation to the drug can be observed easily. Okay, so these adverse events are also provided with the SOC, system organ class and preferred term manner. Okay, this ear and labyrinth disorder, this is a SOC, system organ class, or the general disorder, this is a system organ class, and application site pain, this is the preferred term. Okay, so this is the final term which is getting categorized or classified in this particular SOC. So SOC related adverse events, like this particular drug is acting more on nervous system or more on skeletal system or more on cardiac system, that can also be observed. Okay, so and these are the certain, if suppose there is any type of limitation or caveat was there in that particular study, because of that the results were affected, this is the space where it should be mentioned. Okay, result point of the results point of contact means this particular field, it takes the 100% responsibility that whatever the results are provided are up to the mark without any type of adjustment or 100% transparent. This is the history of change. So if any type of data is getting changed or amended, okay, this is a track. It is a track produced that how and which data was amended. Okay, so like this particular entire site this particular type of disclosure is providing the entire information related to the clinical trial, that what has happened and what was the scenario. Coming back to the presentation, is my screen visible, sir? My presentation is visible.
No, sir.
Yes. Okay.
No.
Okay. Just a minute. Is it visible now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes.
Okay. So
yes, the PPT is visible.
PPT is visible. Okay. Then the another part of regulatory the disclosure document is redacted regulatory documents. In this this particular type of the disclosure part provides you the clinical trial protocols, the statistical analytical procedures, and the clinical study report. So this particular documents are the final documents and which are approved from the regulatory bodies as a protocol or as a result. Okay, directly those documents are made available in the public domain. These particular documents are the best disclosures because they provide you the entire whatever was the actual situation during the conduct of clinical trial can be showcased. Okay. In this particular documents provide you the subject level data as well, that is which participant had what type of problem, which participant had what type of readings of a particular parameter, that everything, the subject level data is available in clinical study report and in clinical trial protocol. What was the actual study design, which parameters were evaluated, what were the inclusion exclusion criteria in depth, what all the care was taken during the conduct of the clinical trial is available. In the statistical analytical procedure provides you the different model of access to the data and how it is analyzed, that entire details are provided. Okay, only the problem about this particular documents, that when you are providing the entire document, okay, like clinical study report, definitely there is certain personal information is available or reported, okay, that let us say subject number 15 staying from this particular state suffered from this particular problem. So this is a personal identification information by which a certain person can reach to the subject. Or apart from the subject, even somebody who is a part of study team or staff, okay, let us say the principal investigator, Mr. XYZ is a principal investigator and he has conducted the study. So if something goes wrong and somebody wants, the personal revenge or something, some sort of, personal problem wanted can be arised. Okay, so for that, the redaction is necessary. In the redaction, the personal identification information is redacted. I hope you everybody know the term redaction. It is masking. It is this kind of masking. Okay. So probably here the name of individuals are there. The subject, directly the subject numbers are there, or the phone numbers are there. So this particular information is hidden. So these documents are processed to avoid disclosing the personal information, identification information, PII. The PII includes the names, direct address, or any other information which can directly or indirectly relate to the specific person. Example is name, street address, telephone number, subject numbers. Okay, so this particular information is to be redacted. So it will not be available in the public domain. Okay, so redacted regulatory document is also one of the, it is a very good disclosure. Then coming to the plain language summary. Now we all all are from the pharmaceutical background, and we know that what are the terminologies or the general jargons related to the clinical research or pharma field. Okay, but many a times it happens that the lay person who was participant in that particular study, or a lay person who is interested to know that what is happening, what is the current status of COVID clinical trial, when he will go, he or she will go to the NIH site, clinicaltrial.gov or CTRI, Clinical Trial Registry of India, okay, will not be able to understand that what exactly it is mentioning, right? So when I have showed you the result summary or the protocol summary, it is understood or we are competent enough to understand because we are from the same field. So the general jargons, the field related jargons are used, and if suppose those are not understood by the general people, then definitely the purpose of putting the information into the public domain is total waste. So for that, the EU, European Union, has taken up the initiative, and they started, they have prepared another rule, okay, to put the information or the details of the clinical trials, each and every clinical trial, in the public domain, written as a plain language summary. Okay, in plain language summary, summaries are written in plain language, help people who are not scientists or doctors understand complex medical terms. Okay, people who participate in clinical trial and others may want to know the information about the clinical study results. Okay, so the entire story needs to be, put in the general, in very general or lay language. Okay, and is possible to do so. Okay, so the lay summaries. Hello.
Hello.
Yes sir. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay. Some scribblings were there in between, so that's why I thought something went wrong. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So the lay summaries are a way to share the clinical study results, but they do not replace other ways that information is shared. Means the summary should be formed in such a way, or the though you are describing some particular scientific information, okay, about a clinical trial, in such a way that the data should not be dumped. Okay, the data should not be the effect of the the data should not be lost, and the proper message should go to the reading person that what the researcher wants to say. Okay, now many a times we used to see when we go to the doctor's clinic, okay, we visit to the clinics, many of the small posters are put as a information towards a certain disorder or certain indication, or cares to be taken, or prophylactic cares. Okay, those are written in very plain language, like they are in very general language. They don't put any type of general jargons. Okay, so we need to write the summaries in such a way that it should be understood by a person who is not related to this particular field. The lay summary writers must think about how they can help readers to understand the information, and the information should be provided in such a way that a sixth grade student shall understand the context. Okay, so even the person who a student who can read English or his own mother tongue, okay, should be able to understand that what the researcher wants to communicate with him. Okay, so for this particular thing, there are many tools like using the readability index, which is one of the tool in Microsoft Office Word, which provides you the easiness or easily understandable language, okay, and what is the index. So generally that index should remain below 10. Okay, in generally whenever we are putting some publication, generally that index used to be beyond 40. So I hope you could understand that how the results are presented in very general language. Okay, now let us discuss about the advantages and disadvantages of disclosure. Definitely there are advantages as well as disadvantages of disclosing the information related to clinical trial in public domain. The advantages are the disclosures make the clinical trial transparent. As I've showed you, the one of the registry, the result registry, that it is indicating each and every factor which was involved during that particular clinical trial, that how many participants were involved, what was the situation, what were the reasons because of that they have withdrawn, what are the results, and how the analysis is taken place. Okay, so quite transparent, and it is, plus it is evaluated and cross-checked through the regulatory body, so there is no chance of hiding some data and posting only the positive things. Correct. Help in the registries, they help, or the disclosures, they help in patient recruitment. As I discussed previously, that those people who wants to get enrolled into the clinical studies for their own treatment can go to these national registries and find out that what type of which trial and at what place the trials are going on, in which they can participate and get the benefits of treatment. The registry helps patients to get enrolled in relevant trials. So vice versa, even the sponsors also face lots of problems for recruitment of the proper person with the proper indication with inclusion and exclusion criteria. So registries does a collaborative or bridging, registries act as a bridging factor which helps the patients to meet the sponsor and sponsors to meet the patients. The quick and scientific reference to the researcher, the registries or the disclosed documents can be utilized by the researchers to schedule or to design their further clinical trial, or to know about a certain drug or the progress of certain clinical trial or drug, about its efficacy or safety. Plus, no repetition of trials with hazardous outcomes. So once the previous person has the earlier, it is reported that this particular drug in this kind of indication is not having good results there, they can produce certain type of adverse events, definitely the further trials can be avoided. Now moving to other disadvantages, disclosing the clinical trial data in public domain definitely hamper the confidentiality, especially the subject level data. When the subject level data comes to the public domain, definitely that can be the confidentiality is breached, as well as the data can be used for further things to develop, which can be utilized by a competitor of the person who is person or the company who has posted that particular data. Increased exposure of information may be closely linked to the process of patenting or a recently discovered use of known drug. So let us say the one of the example as aspirin, if it is some trial is undergone for the COVID-19 and aspirin is one of the useful drug into it, but in case of COVID-19 it is fine that it is a helpful data, and aspirin is also a generic product, so it can be used. But if suppose there is any other drug which is having which is investigated by one of the company for its indication, and now it is putting all those results into the public domain, definitely it can hamper the market size of that particular company or organization. So this is all about the disclosure. I'm at the end of the presentation, and the almost all the necessary things which are required in the academic field, for to know about the disclosure are mentioned.
Hello, sir.
So I'm at the end of the presentation. So are there any questions?
Namrata ma'am.
Thank you, sir, for the informative session. Due to time constraint, we are skipping the question answer session.
Okay, that's fine.
Thank you so much.
So we will let you on mail the questions.
Definitely, sir. Definitely. Yeah. No
thank
problem.
You very much for informative session. It's a new knowledge. It has been added to my brain. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Thank you, sir.
So here we are the closing today's meet. Namrata ma'am, can you continue?
Yeah. Yeah, so here we come to an end to the day 4 of EFDP, and I would like to thank all the speakers to letting us through the different angles and aspects of drug development, and I would like to thank all the participants who have joined today, and till then, tomorrow we'll meet at the same place, same time. Till then, stay home, stay safe, bye-bye. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you, sir.